Vancouver Ford text line. We were talking about when to pick up if you're a bad golfer. And let me just say to the people that are chiming in on this, first off, you're completely wrong. If you are, what did you say? You said your grandfather.
Yeah, my grandfather had the old adage, if you're good, play fast. Yeah. If you're bad, play faster.
Now, I understand that there is a theory out there that you paid to golf. Therefore, you can take as much time as you want. And, you know, you paid to putt it out. You putt it out. First off, you're wrong. That is a terrible way to go about things. Now, if you're there and you're the only one on the course, you're playing by yourself, there's no one around you, or you're in a twosome and there's no one in front or behind, by all means, play seven balls. I don't care. But if it's 75 and it's sunny,
it's entirely to do with your surroundings,
yes,
the flow of the course,
yes,
and everything else.
You are there with a group of people. You are not an island unto yourself, right? You are there in a communal thing, and we're on a journey together. Especially if you're the worst one in the group, read the room. Read instead of reading the green.
And doing it to your own group is bad enough. If you're doing it to groups behind you,
yes,
God forbid, you need to stop.
If you are the worst golfer in your group, you have to make sure that you are the first one done every time. And if that means picking it up out of the greenside bunker and saying, don't worry, boys, this one's done.
No, yes, you've got to keep pace with the next best player. That needs to be your goal.
Exactly. It's done. I understand that everyone else is putting and you just crisscrossed the green seven times, then you're done. I don't care that you don't get
to
post.
If you wanted to putt it out, you needed to hit your first couple straight.
Exactly. It's over. It's over. And by the way, you don't need to make 1,000 excuses. You're just like, hey, it's not for me today, right? I'm picking this one up. And even if they're like, oh, go ahead, putt that one out. You know what you say? Nah, I'm good. Let's move on to the next one. And at that point, just start drinking, right? Light the cigar. Start drinking and realize that today is not going to be the day that you break the course record. Have fun and make sure that everyone else has fun.
Gold jacket, green jacket, who gives a
There you go. All right, today's AAA heating and cooling poll question. You can find it at X or Twitter, whatever the hell you're calling that. We asked the question today, with events like the Masters, what drives your interest and compels you to watch? Storylines, star players, all watch regardless. Or what's the Masters? We ask you to vote and vote hard. I was thinking about this today when we saw Scheffler and DeChambeau up there. And anytime, you know, Tiger made the cut for the 24th straight time. And, you know, one of the big storylines going into the Masters this year and really going into every golf tournament, unfortunately, is the whole PGA Live thing.
Sure.
I'd make the argument that that is the biggest story in golf.
It's the most consistent one, yeah.
And that is a problem,
mm-hmm,
I think, for golf. I think it's a huge problem for golf. Because in sports like golf, and I would say to an extent in sports other than the NFL really is, in my mind, the only real sport that doesn't need anything. It just works.
Sure.
The NFL, it doesn't matter if it's two interesting teams. It doesn't matter if it's an offensive game, if it's a defensive game. It doesn't matter if it's on Peacock. It doesn't matter if it's on Amazon.
No, you can give me the Jaguars and the Cardinals on a Thursday night, and we're watching it, it's fine, and it'll probably be competitive, and then we'll have things to talk about.
Yes, there's always something there. Yeah. But outside of that, I think you need a hook. And that's why I said with the Masters, like the Masters is enough to draw eyeballs.
Baseball's dying because of that, like,
yes,
viewership-wise. Like,
yes.
There
and so
are...
is golf. Golf right now, golf's, yeah, viewership is getting slaughtered,
yep,
on a weekly basis.
Because most of the rivalries are gone, and half of the players that people are interested in following are gone, and no one wants to watch the new product, and the old product is suffering because part of the old product is gone, and it's just, it's rough.
And so when you're... The Masters is good enough to draw in eyeballs, but we live in a weird little, sometimes insulated world when we're in the world of sports. Like, to Rob, like, Rob watches the Valero Open, for God's sakes. Mm-hmm. You know, Dirt watches the Sony Open or watches the Genesis. I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but you're like one of seven people that watch that. It's the same thing with like women's basketball this year. Women's basketball is a growing sport, right? It's actually, you know, it's kind of growing and it's thriving and it's better than ever. But when we see numbers like what we saw in this year's tournament, why was that? It was because of Caitlin Clark. Well, it was because of Caitlin Clark and the LSU thing from last year, and then it kind of grew off of that.
Mm-hmm.
Now we'll see if women's basketball can take that next jump. But there was a moment in time, there was a storyline, there was a star player.
A perfect
storm. There was a perfect storm of things that came about. And I think when you're talking about most sports, especially some of the fringe sports like golf, if you're the Masters, you need something. You desperately need something. And no offense to Scheffler and DeChambeau, who, like, Scheffler might be the best golfer we've seen in 20 years.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Scottie Scheffler is the best golfer in the world, period, of end of story. And DeChambeau
and
is...
And he can't putt, really.
No.
Which is crazy.
And DeChambeau is he's a big character, right? Yep. And kind of a controversial guy.
He's an enigma.
Yeah. And DeChambeau and Scheffler are both... They're decent draws.
Yeah.
But they're not going to draw enormous eyeballs. This isn't Tiger. This isn't Rory. This isn't Phil.
Mm-mm.
And for a sport like golf, what you're doing right now with the splitting of this thing, what you're saying is the only reason to tune in now is the Masters. The Masters, or if one of our old heads, if Tiger, if Phil, or if Rory kind of shoves it back up and into the sun one more time, because there's a lot of really good young players. You know, look at from Homa to Zalatoris to some of the rookies, the debutantes, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of good stories, but those aren't compelling stories unless you're a golf fan. I was sitting there today kind of going through this and thinking, what is the best story? What is the driving force right now? And honestly, outside of Tiger making the cut and maybe Scheffler kind of having, you know, the lowest odds since Tiger in his prime. But no offense to Scottie Scheffler, but he's like the most boring, nondescript human being on the planet.
Yeah, he's got a little bit of Mike Trout in him in that way,
yeah,
where it's just like, I mean, he's phenomenal, but like, he's vanilla.
So what's the storyline? Outside of it being Augusta National, and if that isn't drawing you in, if the idea of the Masters doesn't get you, and I'd make the argument that the Masters gets golf fans every year, but it doesn't draw big numbers because it only gets golf members. It only gets the golf fan. What is driving eyeballs to the game of golf, to the Masters? Because with the women's tournament and why it broke records, Caitlin Clark, Kim Mulkey, Gino, all the WNBA players taking shots at Caitlin Clark, Dawn Staler and company taking shots at Caitlin Clark, they were all able to build off one key central figure in Caitlin Clark,
mm-hmm.
and then there were a lot of offshoots.
Sure.
And that led to monster ratings. And right now with
we used to be able to do that with Tiger, but even his presence isn't consistent enough that we get to even do that anymore.
So, like, as I'm watching this, and I enjoy watching the Masters, I enjoy the pageantry of it, but I think if you're the PGA right now, if you're LIV Golf, I think if you're just in the sport of golf in general, I'm not certain what's drawing eyeballs to your sport. And right now, numbers have never been worse. It's and you've now got LIV Golf guys coming out and saying that we can't do this. There's no one at our tournaments. No one's watching. And it's, as much as I love the Masters, I think this year and kind of the lack of juice around this tournament, I think says something about the state of affair in golf.
Yeah, for me, I mean, the answer to the poll question for me is that I'm going to watch regardless.
Yes.
Because I love this tournament more than any of the others. I think there's a familiarity to it for people because all the other majors, you know, they move sites and whatnot, but people know what to expect here. There's the tradition, the history. That is, I think, the draw for this year. The one other thing that sometimes gets me is like, is there the guy who's going to go get his first jacket and that's going to be an exciting run? Is it somebody that's going to come out of nowhere? Or is it somebody that you wished always...
Got one and never did,
and we don't even have that going on right now.
But even if you did get that, let's say you got Xander Schauffele, right?
Or Homa, who's tied for first right now.
Yeah, the nice stories, but...
But not enough of a draw.
They're not getting casual sports fans.
No, I would agree.
They're not bringing casual eyeballs to the set. And right now, in the world of golf, they got to figure this out.
Mm-hmm.
Because if there is a lack of juice around the Masters... My God, what happens for the rest of the year?
Well, perfect example, one of my buddies today, we were on the group chat talking about Bryson, and I guess he had a new set of irons 3D printed a week before the tournament
and then got him
approved or whatever. Like, that's been a talking point and kind of what he is and the way he operates is a talking point. And my buddy goes, you know, I think he's a douche, but I'd miss having him on tour so we can at least talk about him. And we need more of that.
And if you brought some of those guys back, if you brought Rahm and DeChambeau and Koepka and they played on the tour, maybe you can build some of those storylines.
Yeah.
And Koepka and DeChambeau was a great
piss and
vinegar
Everybody
rivalry.
Loved that. There were memes all over the place.
But now that they're at LIV and we don't think about them anymore, and all of a sudden they're back at the Masters.
Out of sight, out of mind.
It's out of sight, out of mind. And it's just, I think there is a real lack of juice around this year's tournament. And if you're the PGA, if you're LIV, you have now, you have your own players from Rahm to Kepka to DeChambeau all basically coming out and saying, this is not good for the game. This is not sustainable. And hopefully we end up with a great tournament. I will, if you get the leaderboard right now, if you give me Homa, DeChambeau, and Scheffler coming down the stretch
on
Sunday, sign me up, right? Sign me up for that. I still don't know if that registers a big number.
I don't think it gets a broad stroke.
And this is the other one that it's a problem is the purists, and this is true in baseball. It's true in golf. We always get this. Well, why do we need the casual fan? Because the casual fan is what makes it go. The diehard will be there. The reason why the NFL is the 8-million-pound gorilla is because everyone watches it and they're not diehards.
And golf rode a tiger wave for 30 years. Or 20 years. And now that wave has crashed down to the beach and there doesn't look like there's another one coming right now.
They got to figure something out. All right, we come back, we'll talk a little state of college football, perhaps, and some NFL stuff. And then don't forget, Angie Machado, Beaver Blitz, will join us at 4 o'clock to talk about the bad situations going down in Corvallis and what can we do about it. Here, though, is Buck with SportsCenter. You can text the program, Vancouver Ford text line. They treat you right before, during, and after the sale. VancouverFord.com. That number, 503-864-6FAN. 503-864-6326. A couple of your texts rolling in. Golf needs another Tiger Woods. That's what Caitlin Clark was for women's basketball. The Tiger Woods of women's basketball. Absolutely. But, like, outside of a generational talent like that, like, if you're a friend sport, if you're swimming, if you're gymnastics, if you're golf, if you're women's basketball, you can't sit there and say, well, we need the next one to come along. That's not a strategy, right? At least it's not a good one. Because there are, like I would say, force multipliers. Lance Armstrong was one. Michael Phelps, Tiger Woods, Caitlin Clark. Those are ones that drive eyeballs, and you may not be able to keep that all of that attention, but you have to be able to grow off of that. And
yeah, what are you going to do? How do you leverage it?
Yes. And someone else said, you know, dig your own grave and crawl in. Yes. Golf, essentially, with the whole live thing, and this is what, like, John Rahm and DeChambeau are talking about. They dug their $300 million graves, and they realize it. Now, to them, you've already made your money. I mean, I get why you did it. You got $300 million. You got $400 million tax-free, probably. I understand why you do that. But I think they're all coming to the realization right now that they are slowly choking the life out of their sport. And while having a bunch of money is awesome, I think you can see real regret on every one of their faces when they go out and play a meaningless tournament every single week that no one's watching. You can absolutely see it.
And you know, I think at the time when the first big wave of people started jumping, there were plenty of people that said, all right, well, you know, they're picking their dance partner and that's the dance they're going to go to. And I think there is a lot of regret about it. But at the same time, there were a lot of people saying, no one's going to watch. No. The tour is going to suck and you're going to have all this money. I hope it's worth it. And that's where some of them are right now.
Someone said, this is like if the no one cared about the Super Bowl, what would the NFL season be like? Yeah. There's a little bit of that because this is, you know, golf and NASCAR are both similar to this in that the biggest event is at the start of the year. Like the biggest NASCAR race is the Daytona 500, and that's at the start.
To their credit, they've tried to fix that they implemented a playoff system, which didn't exist before. So now there is, on the final race of the season, one winner who lifts the trophy.
And golf is doing the same thing with the
FedEx Cup.
The FedEx Cup.
Yep. But the FedEx Cup doesn't, I don't think, moves the needle like majors do. I do think for NASCAR followers, having a playoff and essentially a Super Bowl at the end helps.
And also, how dumb is it now that in the PGA Tour that 6 to 10 of the best golfers in the world aren't even competing
and
for that?
And that's a massive problem. I mean, especially after we were told they're all going to play nice and play together again, but now they're not. They're under the same umbrella, but they're not. They haven't merged back. I mean, I don't. You need those 6 to 10 players and personalities.
You do. Like I said, I think every sport needs this with the exception of football. Football's the one thing. Well, we know that the best part about football is football. So, you know, you just have
the best part of football is football. And so you got to do football.
And as long as you do football, it seems that there is nothing that stops football. The concussion thing we thought may be it was killing people. You had former players shooting themselves in the chest so that their brains can be studied. We had, for the first time ever, we had a link to ALS. Like, we're not really certain what causes ALS, but someone finally put it together that it may not be the only way, but apparently getting hit in the head, not good for you. We know it causes dementia. We know it causes Alzheimer's. I mean, God, we made a movie about it called Concussion.
Yeah.
Right? Like, this was going to be the one that brought down the NFL. $1 billion. They paid out $1 billion. And guess what?
Hasn't changed a thing.
Hasn't changed a thing.
I mean, nothing. There might be the occasional, like, we've changed kickoffs, so we have fewer of them, but, you know, the game hasn't changed.
And then we had this sports now, it's gone full sissy. And we can't hit anyone anymore, and it's terrible, and this is just god-awful. Well, no, the ratings keep going up. And then it was, I don't want politics in my sports, and you had the president coming out and saying to fire these sons of bitches, and Colin Kaepernick was the worst thing in the world, and we had a race war.
He's a traitor!
Those sons of bees, and just awful, and I'm never watching again. Well, guess what? Ratings bigger than ever. I mean, there is nothing that stops the NFL. It is a freight train straight from the pits of hell. What's that pit like out in Turkmenistan? They call it the, I think they call it the gates of hell. There's a pit in Turkmenistan that's been burning for 40 years. 40 straight years. You can go over there and
see it.
That's
terrifying.
Yeah, like look it up sometime. It is, it's on that dark tourist show that I was telling you
about.
Oh,
yeah.
Yeah. You can go to, like, Turkmenistan's like, it's like a mini North Korea. It's like run by a full-on dictator. Terrifying stuff. But yeah, there is a giant pit that I guess it's like an underground gas thing that someone lit on fire 4 decades ago, still burning. And not like kind of burning, no.
Raging?
Raging.
So is that because, is there like natural gas underneath that
something
continues
like
it going?
It's like natural gas and oil. Look it up. They call it the gates of the pits of hell. That's the NFL. Nothing stops it. You say you're going to stop it, but it doesn't. So I'm going to ask the question, does college football have that? Does college football have the NFL natural gas oil reserves underneath to keep burning?
I used to think so.
Does college football have a little bit of the live golf stuff? We'll talk about that when we come back. And then someone that's hitting probably a little too close to home, Angie Machado, will join us at 4 o'clock from Beaver Blitz to talk about just this very thing. So a little college football transition when we come back. Primetime here on The Fan.
The Fan is...
Rocking You on a Friday. We're talking about, I don't know what.
Rocking You on a Friday. Why did I say that?
By the way, the drop bracket, the Asace and Sug drop bracket, you know, the champions are going toe-to-toe right now.
They certainly are.
Between Rocking You on a Friday and My Son is an Idiot. And I'm not going to reveal anything.
My son is an idiot.
We're going to wait till Asace comes back, but I'll just say right now that My Son's an Idiot. It might be UConn basketball at this point.
Feels like a pretty dominant force.
It is drilling people right now in the tournament. I mean, there's been some close battles.
In a lot of these drops,
but I'll tell you what, My Son's an Idiot is...
My Son is an Idiot.
Dude, My Son's an Idiot's grabbing rebounds, we're throwing outlet passes, we're throwing down dunks, we're shooting the three. Dude, it's tough.
Rocking You on a Friday? Why did I say that?
And I was talking to my kid about it, and he goes, do you even remember why you called me an idiot? And I'm like, I have no idea.
I think I've asked you that as well. I'm like, and what was it referenced to? And you're like, I don't know.
I don't know, dude. That thing was so long ago. Yeah, there could have been a million reasons why I said my son's an idiot. I think it was something along the lines of, you know, like a lot of people romanticize their kids. You know, like as parents, I think it's natural that we want to prop up our children, and I am not one of those.
As far as the, like, you mean like my kid's the cutest, the most adorable, the best
the cutest,
to ever do
my
it kind
kid's
of a thing?
The best. You know how many people I run into that are like, my kid's going to be in the, like, if they find out that I played, and I always tell them I didn't play in the NFL, I stood on the sidelines in the NFL, my kid's going to be in the NFL. I'm sure that they are.
Definitely going to be in the NFL.
And their daughter's going to be Taylor Swift and this and that. And, you know, it's like everyone's kid is so unique and special. I think it was somewhere along the lines of, I love my child, but my son's an idiot. It's
my son is an idiot.
I think it was, if I remember, I think it was something along that, making a larger point of, while I love my child, I love him dearly, and he's a talented young man. And I think
it was the qualifier at the end.
It's the qualifier, yes. Like
he's a great individual. I'll love him at the end of the time, but my son is an idiot.
Yes, because all kids are morons.
Yes.
Like everyone,
I've learned this.
Every one of my children at some point, and by at some point I mean on a regular basis, does something that I stare at them and I'm like, what in God's green earth are you doing? And then I think back to when I was a kid. Oh my God. Like I say this with no pride in this, no shame. It's just the fact I cannot imagine what it was like to try to raise me. I get it. I remember.
Little hellion.
Well, and I wasn't a bad kid. I was a lot. How about that?
Sure.
I was a lot.
My brother was a lot.
Right?
He was a lot.
You got one of those kids that's just a lot?
Yes.
I think I was a lot. I remember one time when I was in school, I got in. This is kind of sums up. I remember feeling bad because I think I broke my mom. Because my mom would get calls from the school about various things that I had done. And nothing horrid. I wasn't getting, like, in a ton of fights.
Just unruly, perhaps.
Just unruly. I got in trouble for something, and they sent me to, like in-house detention. You remember that? Like, you'd have to go sit in a room.
Yeah, like an in-school suspension kind of a deal?
In-school suspension. And you had to fill out a plan.
How are you going to be better?
Yeah. I may have faked dyslexia in said thing. Like, you have to write out the plan of action.
You tried to make yourself look dumber so you could get out of punishment?
No, I just was being an ass. And they called in, like, a specialist. And I didn't know. So the next day I showed up for, like, the in-house detention,
mm-hmm.
and they're
meeting with someone to help you with your issue?
Like, to talk and see if I had one. And I guess they called my mom and was like, I think your son may have a whatever. And I had to, like, come clean and be like, oh, I may have done this. And it was not well met.
I bet not.
No.
Because at that point, you're not just being unruly. Now you're wasting other people's time.
Yeah. And I remember my mom just looking at me, and she started crying. And I just felt terrible. I absolutely felt awful. And my mom looked at the people and was like, don't call me again for this. You deal with it. And she just walked away. I remember sitting there in the room, and like staring at like the vice principal, like the associate principal, as my mom walked away, just left school.
I'm out.
And staring at like the reading specialist who looked at me like I was the worst human being on the planet. And I didn't have an... There's no excuse for it. You can't explain that away.
But you're just doing dumb kid stuff.
Yeah, you just kind of sit there and you're like... And then
what do you want?
And then they're asking, then I have to fill out, again, another plan of why I did what I did. There was no reason. There's no reason to fake dyslexia other than I'm kind of a lot. I'm just sorry. I was a lot. And that's
I buy that.
That's kids. I love my son. I love all my kids.
No,
but sometimes, much like me, my son was an idiot.
My son is an idiot moment came for me just the other day. He put like a blanket over his head, was running around the house. I'm like, oh, that's bad. He's going to run into something. He runs into the recliner, knocks him over, starts to cry. What does he do? He puts the blanket right back on his head and runs into the same recliner again, and he cries again. And I'm like, dude, you're an idiot. Why did you do that again?
Yeah.
And there we have it.
It's maybe he will just be again. How's your kid? He's a
my
lot.
Son is an idiot.
He's a lot. We come back. College football, are they digging their own grave? Is this an isolated thing? And what can be done in Corvallis? Angie Machado, Beaver Blitz, joins us. Coming up next, primetime here on The Fan. Men, hour two here on a picturesque spring Friday here in the Rose City, watching a little Masters. Joey Harrington will join us at 5:30. Want to swing on down to Corvallis, though, and talk to friend of the program, Beaver Blitz's own, owner and proprietor from 24/7 and CBS Sports, Angie Machado, beaverblitz.com. Any truth to the rumor that you, too, have entered the transfer portal?
I have not entered the portal. But I also don't have any major big NIL deals. So, you know, it just is what it is. Just keep the grind alive.
I'm being dead serious on that. I don't ever recall anything quite like this. I'm trying to think of another situation outside of, like, SMU getting the death penalty. But that was in one sport, right? That was their football team died, and that'll never happen again. I'm trying to think of another situation in recent memory where you have, let's say, not a great men's basketball program, but one that a couple years ago was in the Elite Eight and had quality players, a football team that was a top 25 team building consistently towards that, a top 10 team in women's basketball, and there's nothing left, and you don't have a conference. I don't know if I've ever seen this.
Yeah, it's sad. It's sad for college sports, I think, you know, when you get down to it. And the transfer portal, it's happening everywhere. I mean, that's and what I kind of get concerned about. I mean, there's a lot of that. We could go a lot of different ways. I mean, some of these with NIL and these, I say agents and air quotes, that are kind of coming out of the woodwork. I hope these guys are getting and these players are getting the best advice, first of all. Second of all, there's no guarantees when you enter the portal. Now, for somebody like Damien, yes. Yeah. But there's no guarantees that you're going to find a better situation. It's just a really interesting dynamic right now. Yes, Oregon State, it does feel like Oregon State just keeps getting punched. But it also feels like a big, giant game of musical chairs because guys are leaving and then – but it makes it hard for a college football fan to really get behind a team when the whole roster is basically turning over, you know, every year.
Yeah, and that's – For the Ohio States of the world and places like that, I mean, we've seen mass defections, but it's usually more role players that haven't really found a footing yet, or a big NIL deal comes along,
it's the guys that aren't playing, and then they're going down maybe to another school that they're going to find playing time.
But with Oregon State, especially with we'll get to the basketball thing in a minute, but with the football team, I mean, it was like the perfect storm of the death of the Pac-12, your coach leaves. But, I mean, I look at it, and it's 14 players, but it's arguably your 14 most important players. And it's one thing to have to replace. This is why I feel so bad for Trent Bray. It's like, it's one thing to replace depth. It's another thing to replace almost every key returning guy you have, and then to sell the vid. Like, what if you're Trent Bray, what are you selling recruits? What are you selling the transfer portal kids on right now?
Yeah, the portal, you're selling guys that want playing time and that want to come in and make an impact. So, and there's guys out there that are like that. They want the opportunity, whether, you know, they didn't feel like they got the shot at their last school, whether they, you know, maybe were buried on a depth chart. So you are selling, come in and play now. Come in, make a contribution. There's some great recruiters on that staff. And I actually say that Oregon State has bettered themselves from a recruiting standpoint with the staff they put together. Thomas Ford, Keith Hayward, Brian Gunderson, Kyle Devan. There's some great recruiters in that group. And I think they can sell it because a lot of them played there. I've talked to them, and this is what they say. Some people run when things get tough, and we're coming to help, and we want to be here, and we want to see this thing through. So there's players on the roster right now that, you know, I think there's people that smell blood in the water, and they're getting offers from other places to come play, and they're staying put because their team needs them. And so it's not all doom and gloom. And there are some, you know, committed players and coaches, and they're got, at the end of the day, there's still guys out there that want to play football. And they want that opportunity, and that's what you sell.
And I don't know how much you know or can or want to talk about it, but it's one thing for a guy to leave. I didn't like the Damian Martinez calling the collective liars. I find that hard to believe that in that instant that they didn't take care of him and that, quote, they lied to me. Do you have any kind of insight towards that?
No, I mean, it's a total he said here, you know, going on. Yeah. But I do think there was an article that came out yesterday from one of you guys' competitors that came out that it laid it out in that, yes, and the NIL, the damn nation NIL has come out and said we pay quarterly based on, you know, what the commitments that they've fulfilled. You know, if Damien was, if he was, you know, promised 400,000 over four quarters, from that article, he was paid 92,000 on March 19th and 8,000 had to go to pay off the car that he purchased.
Yeah.
There's his 100,000. I mean, I think he backtracked. I think, you know, I don't know. I don't know if he just did that on his own. I mean, at the end of the day, he's a 20-year-old kid.
Yeah.
And there's that argument. It's, you know, people say, oh, he's just a kid. Okay, but we're talking big decisions, big money. He wants to be treated like a professional. Then he has to, you know, make some, you know, man decisions here. So, and handle things and handle some criticism from the fan base or people out in the world.
Yeah, we're having this weird kind of line that we're dancing now because even I've been doing this 20 years and I've always said, you know, I try to tread a little carefully when I'm talking about collegiate athletes.
College kids.
If I'm watching an NFL game and the left tackle is getting smoked, I have no problem saying that that's not good enough. He's, you know, that's a terrible game. I've always treaded a little lightly, you know, when you're dealing with a 19-year-old freshman that's playing left tackle. But it is kind of getting to this weird point now where, you know, with NIL and millions of dollars in the transfer portal and it becoming more and more professional, we're still getting this blowback of, well, you can't be critical or you need to lay off this. You know, we can't talk about Bronny James. Well, if you're making $4 million in NIL money and you're bouncing around, I you know, do the gloves come off a little bit?
And you have to look at this, the NIL and their scholarships are being funded by boosters.
Yeah.
This is, you know, your fan base is supporting you. I was the same way, you know, for I've done it now 18 years. It's always been, okay, I will be critical of the coaches or the administrators that are making, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars. They're adults, but now you have these college athletes, and I get it, you know, their frontal lobe isn't fully developed and there's a lot of learning and growing up they have to do. But at the same time, they're basically professionals at this point. So I don't know how much you dance around. I mean, they want the notoriety. They want to be considered professional, you know, and I say that in air quotes.
Yeah.
But then I think they have to grow a thicker skin and realize that, yeah, you're going to have to, like you said, an NFL game, you can sit and, you know, criticize left tackle. Yeah. He knows he had a bad game, but you can criticize him on air. These players now, it's kind of put up or shut up.
Yeah, it's like if you sign a free agent deal and go to the worst team and you go play for the Cardinals and your season falls apart, I have no problem being, what a terrible decision. And it's kind of funny that, like, hey, man, you chase the bag, enjoy it. But you do that in college, and now we're kind of getting blowback.
You're a bad guy.
You know, I think some of that stuff is starting to change a little bit. We're talking with Angie Machado, BeaverBlitz.com. I mean, you're connected to that program and the fan base. Obviously, I mean, you make your living off of diehard Beaver fans. And I've heard from so many that I feel like at times just want to throw their hands up and be like, well, what are we doing here? Like, you're asking us to fund this. You're asking us to buy tickets. You're asking us to go all in. And it feels like the blows just keep coming. Obviously, the university has a plan to keep the sports teams going and keep them afloat. But how do they keep the fans engaged? How do they keep the fans from throwing their hands up and saying it doesn't matter what we do? You know, we can't win at this.
Yeah, I mean, you know, there's something to be said. I mean, right now, Oregon State and Washington State can't really even do anything until after, like, August 1, just because of the settlement.
Yeah.
But it'd be nice to hear from Scott Barnes, you know, and kind of what's going on. And I think everybody felt like maybe we were kind of on this path. Football, if football could win 9, 10, 11 games this year to stay relevant and, you know, keep you know, get into a good bowl game, there's some talk there. I think the biggest blow right now has been women's basketball.
Yeah.
Because here's a team that Elite Eight, they were all scheduled to come back.
Everybody.
And now you have seven of them in the portal. So That to me speaks like, okay, maybe this plan that Scott Barnes has said is, you know, we have a plan isn't as strong as we all thought or we're hoping. So I hope administration will come out even, you know, even if they don't have an update, but, you know, say we have some things, fires and, you know, irons in the fire, we're working on some things. Our fan base is strong. I mean, but like you said, Beaver Blitz members, they're, you know, subscribing to a website. We give them as much inside info as we can. We're at practice every day. They're the breathe, live, sleep, eat yeah. Beaver football. Oregon State had got to this point where, you know, you have this nice new side of the stadium. Yeah. They were selling out. And I hope they don't lose the casual fan because then it does spell disaster. But you can't throw up your hands at this point because just – you know, I think there was this thought that Oregon State and Washington State would roll over and just go into the Mountain West, and that's a death sentence. Yeah. So you have to scrap, you have to fight to keep the funding to somehow, you know, with the ACC right now, that's going to blow up here before we know it. So there's going to be more shifting. There's going to be more more movement. I think we all see the writing on the wall that the SEC and the Big Ten want to kind of have this super league, super, you know, mini NFL, if you will, NFL light, but there's still going to be a lot of space, whether that's ACC, Big 12, Pac-2, maybe it's creating, merging those three into like a, some type of a conference, more, you know, regional based, but kind of together. I don't know what the answer is. And people that make a lot more money than me figure that stuff out, but something's got to change.
Yeah. The end game has to be the Big 12 or the ACC, right? It's the only endgame,
it's the only.
Right?
It is the only, because you can't sustainable. I mean, the TV revenue alone, yeah. You would be cutting sports. You would be cutting the department. It's not feasible. So it has to be. And like I said, I think there's got to be something there too, because at some level, I think fans across the country, if you're not a Big Ten or a SEC school, there's still that desire to have some regionality. Yeah. And so I think at some level, the TV execs and the powers that be will figure that out. But it sure as heck is a bumpy ride right now.
Yeah, it's I feel terrible because I've never seen anything quite like it. And quite frankly, I don't think the university, I don't think the players and certainly the fans, I don't think they deserve this. So the two things before I let you go, how worried should Oregon State fan be in that, an Elite Eight team that should have been a contender, last one out, turn the lights off. Should we be concerned that Ruick's the next one out the door? And the crown jewel right now of the athletic department, the baseball team, we haven't seen that affected. Is there a shoe to be dropped there? Or is that sport kind of unique in that, you know, we've seen powerhouses, you know, the Pepperdines and the Cal States that have been able to exist outside of a Power Five dynamic. Are they insulated, or is that potentially the next shoe to drop?
No, I actually think baseball is going to be okay. And I say that kind of with a grain of salt, because look at women's basketball. I thought they'd be okay. Yeah. I've asked that same question. I was talking with someone close to the department just yesterday and said, I mean, is this just like writing on the wall that Ruick's leaving? And, you know, they didn't have an answer. They don't know. So he had an impassioned talk. I don't know if you saw it.
Yeah, it was
after
great.
The Elite Eight.
I thought it was amazing.
It was great. I mean, it was a really heartfelt, you know, talk about being a Beav and his mom's a Beav and all this stuff. So I don't know about that, but baseball, it is, it's the bright spot right now. But with them going independent, and then you have the entire pack, the former Pac-10, they're going to be looking for base. They're going to be looking for out of conference. So I see that schedule being, they'll be fine. I mean, they're going to be scheduling Oregon and ASU and Cal and Stanford and Arizona. They have to, because those schools can't be traveling to the East Coast, you know, week in and week out. So they're going to need some local schools to help, you know, boost RPI.
Yeah. Like the,
I think they're going to be okay.
Well, I hope so. Cause that's, I mean, right now that's what you got to hang your hat on. And I hope Ruick sticks around and kind of rebuilds this thing. But at the same time, like I say this about anyone, you can come out and say, hey, I'm in this for the long haul. I'm doing the right thing. But circumstances change, and I get it. If you get backed into a corner where you feel that you can't succeed, I don't think it's fair to ask a guy to sacrifice a career if he doesn't feel that he can succeed. So I hope that's
absolutely
not the case. And I loved what he had to say after the loss, but You know, that was before he lost literally every returning player that he had coming back.
But it's going to be, it comes down to then how you handle it. Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, that was the problem with Jonathan Smith leaving. If he would have handled it differently, yeah. I don't think Beaver fans would be upset with him. But yeah. the way he handled it, yeah. That's what kind of hurt his stock in Corvallis. Yeah.
Well, we hope for you know, brighter days ahead, because it's been a rough go down there for the Beaver faithful, and we feel for him down there, and we know that you'll be covering it and giving us all the updates. BeaverBlitz.com. Find her on Twitter. She does a great job doing it for almost 20 years. Friend of the program, Angie Machado, thank you for taking a couple minutes for us.
Thanks for having me on.
Yeah, I cannot recall another situation like this in NCAA history. This is for an entire athletic program. I hope the baseball team continues, because right now that's what you have to hold on
well,
to.
Well, and honestly, the fact that they, I feel like, almost got ahead of this thing, deciding, no, we're good enough. No Mountain West. Let's make our own schedule. Let's pick our opponents. Let's make sure that we stay top of mind, at least in the collegiate baseball world. I think that was really smart. I don't know that you could do that with, say, the women's basketball team, yeah. but if you could, that'd be awesome.
Fingers crossed. And then in regards to football, when we come back, I'll have this discussion, because does this and what's going on, does this hurt? It hurts regional football, but does it hurt the sport? Or is college football have a little bit of that NFL and they're insulated from this sort of thing? We'll talk about that when we come back. Primetime here on The Fan. Vancouver Ford text line. We're literally witnessing the death of OSU athletics. Scott Barnes is way overpaid, especially now that they are a Mountain West WCC program. It's just death by a thousand cuts. Feels that way sometimes. I get why people feel that way.
Scott, the death by a thousand cuts part feels, it does feel like every day there's one more shred of news that makes you feel like it's all crumbling down.
Scott Rourke should take a better job. There's another one. Again, I hope he doesn't. I hope he sticks it out, but I can't blame him if he does.
My question, and I was talking with Nemec a little bit about this last night, is how long, and not knowing could kill you too, but how long is the wait until the dust settles and some of these programs, whether they're individually or together, are able to land somewhere? Because if you can hold on to Ruick for a year and make a deal 2 years from now to be joining another conference, like maybe you could pull that off. Yeah, but
you go from a TV deal that's probably going to pay
gotta be working ahead though for that
$4 million a year to one that pays you 30 plus, and you get a bigger slice of the college football pie and the NCAA basketball pie, and you'll be fine. But yeah, it's these next 2 years are going to be rough. Now, in regards to the idea that like this kills college athletics, I'm not certain that it does. Like, we were talking earlier that the idea of golf and baseball to an extent, these all need kind of fringe niche sports. They need stories. They need stars, right? You need things to get casual fans to tune in. The one sport that is different than that is football. The NFL doesn't need any of those things. It helps.
The best part of football is football. And so you got to do football.
Yeah, when you get the Chiefs and you get the, you know, when Brady and Mahomes are going head-to-head, or when you get Mahomes and Allen, yeah, that drives people. But the numbers are fine. Thursday Night Football can have two ridiculous teams and it plays on Amazon and it still draws 20 million people. Like, it's an absolute juggernaut. And as college sports starts to get transformed, no one's watching men's college basketball anyways. The NCAA tournament is different. That's an entity unto itself, and people will continue to watch that. And so if you do see kind of the regional, the smaller schools kind of die off, I really wonder what the impact is going to be. I hear from people all the time being like, well, college sports is dying. And I'm like, well, I disagree with that. I think it's shifting, and I think in some places – Corvallis, Washington State, the little corners of the world, the smaller schools, maybe even some of the smaller schools in the Power Four, you know, the Big 12 schools, right? The BYUs of the world, or let's go with the Rutgers or something like that. I can certainly see, although Rutgers is getting Big 10 money, so it's really the Big 12 and the ACC schools, right? I can see some of those schools kind of going by the wayside, the Mountain West schools, the WCC schools, but that to me isn't the death of anything.
No, it's not.
That is more of like you're having some fingers falling off, but the body, the organs, like your heart is healthier than ever, because we talked about it in that storylines drive sports. And as we condense, at least in the world of college football and maybe even college basketball,
you may not need a Vanderbilt or a Rutgers here or there to have those storylines.
Yes.
But at the same time, you lose enough of those other schools and it only becomes the haves playing the haves and none of the have-nots are around anymore. A little bit of that essence of it is gone. Not because like they make the sport what it is, but I think it would be a bummer, at least for those alumni bases, like that we're seeing with Oregon State and Washington State now, to see that die off, see the end of tailgates for whatever.
I think it becomes less interesting, and I think, for groups of people, it sucks. But
for watching college football on TV, you'll get the best and the best more often, probably.
When Alabama and Michigan played, 27 million people tuned in. The biggest game rated every year is what? It's Michigan and Ohio State. It's the biggest game every year. Notre Dame isn't even an elite team anymore.
And they haven't been for a while.
Yes, and yet Notre Dame's TV deal pays them $40 million
a
year.
It's so good that they won't join a conference, or at least they hadn't until...
No, they don't have to.
Yeah.
Because it's Notre Dame. So yes, while I hate that we have the death of the Pac-12. I hate it. I think it absolutely stinks that Stanford and Cal are in the freaking ACC. I hate that I now have to... Utah and Arizona are in the Big 12. I hate what happened to Washington State and Oregon State. It absolutely sucks. And if the ACC dies off here in a couple years, I think for fan bases, it sucks. But I really don't. Anyone that says this is the death of college sports, I don't buy that for a second. I think it's the death of fingers and toes. And yes, you're not as nimble. Maybe you're not as pretty, you're not as attractive, but for the health, all you're doing is fortifying the heart and the organs.
Yeah.
Because whether anyone wants to admit it or not, the big ratings in college football, the big ratings in college basketball are when you have big time programs. When TCU plays Georgia in the national title game, it's not the same as when Georgia plays Alabama. It's not the same as when Ohio State plays. Even a school like Oregon. Oregon draws some of the biggest numbers. And that's the crappy part about Washington State and Oregon State is they draw numbers.
Yeah.
They do.
They were not an anchor dragging everybody else down.
No.
That's the part that sucks.
And they are
putting together a decent product.
Yes.
More often than not with the resources they had, and people wanted to watch them play.
And it sucks. But it's not going to drag down college football.
No, it's not going to stop people from wanting to watch the Ohio States, the Alabamas.
And NIL isn't going to drag it down, and realignment isn't going to drag it down. And if you go to two super conferences, it's not going to drag it down. I do feel that the NCAA basketball tournament, men's and women's perhaps, and certainly college football and the playoff, this has an NFL quality to it. This can't kill it. It just can't. You will get better storylines. You will get bigger games, and you will get bigger audiences. Maybe regionally, again, you may not like it. And maybe out in Corvallis, and maybe out in Portland, and maybe out on the West Coast, and maybe in some ACC territories, you say, well, I don't want to watch anymore. And that's a bummer for you, but 30 million people are going to tune into the college football playoff next year. 30 million.
Yep, and maybe more as it expands. I mean, like, and it'll be what people want to see.
It sucks, but I think it's the truth. It's not the death. This isn't Liv and the PGA killing off a fringe sport. It just doesn't. I think college football and college basketball, I think they're going to continue to grow to the expense of some people, and I don't like that. But it's going to continue to grow.
Yep.
We come back in the news here, though. Buckley with SportsCenter. No. 5 going into 18 when he had a horrific double bogey to find himself going from plus 5 to plus 7 and not playing on the weekend.
Well, I can say that pleases me because I was on the fade Justin Thomas train this week. And I played against him twice today. I had Patrick Cantlay with a better score and Tony Finau with a better score. So I'll take those.
There is nothing better or worse than a horrific backdoor cover, or in this case, getting backdoored. Where you're sitting there, you got Justin Thomas. If you got Justin Thomas making the cut, you're sitting there, you're like, he's going to 18. Dude, he bogeys and I'm still fine. And the man goes out and does that. That hurts. That's the meaningless field goal at the end of a game that ends up breaking your back.
Well, and I would imagine, I always think about this, not for the guys who are always in the mix winning tournaments, but guys who are always on the fringe, and that is not Justin Thomas. Historically, he's been great. Yeah. But the guys who, missing the weekend cost them a significant chunk of change.
Yes.
You know, I mean, like, you're not going to...
JT's doing fine, but
he's doing fine, but for the guys who were one shot off of making five figures, maybe six, I mean, that's a bummer.
Yeah. El Chocorino. All right, it is April 12th in the year of our Lord, 2024. It is time for In the News. I'm your noted news contributor, sitting in for your noted news man, Asachi, who is down at Augusta, not on the course today. Playing golf, he'll be there on Sunday. Keep an eye out for him. It is National Grilled Cheese Day, and let me tell you something. A grilled cheese is delightful. A grilled cheese done well, chef's kiss.
I have a question for you. I didn't really even realize there was another way to do this until recently. Outside of your grilled cheese, do you put butter or mayonnaise?
Oh, I've seen the mayonnaise one, but no, I'm a butter and then some. I got a season. If you're just doing butter on your grilled cheese, get out of here. What are you doing? Whether you do mayonnaise or whether you do butter, the key to any quality grilled cheese is whether you do some garlic salt, you do some seasoning salt.
A little Cajun seasoning,
some Cajun seasoning.
Old Bay?
Yeah, you got to have something in there. You want to throw some paprika? I actually have some, like, steak seasoning.
Mm-hmm.
Dave Bartu, little hint here. Dave Bartu, master of all things.
Mm-hmm.
Master of hemp products, master of analytics. That son of a gun has a barbecue rub. If you're listening, Dave Bartu.
I'm going to need that.
I haven't received any in a long time, and I'm not happy about
it. Going to need that.
He just has a big bag of seasoning, and I don't know what's in it, but holy God, you can put that thing on anything.
I love that.
Chicken, pork, whatever. And I started, and I haven't had this in years, but I sprinkled some onto a grilled ham and cheese.
Okay, I see you.
And also, two things. I need meat in my grilled cheese. Why would I just make a grilled cheese when I can throw some ham or some turkey?
Yeah, I almost always make mine a grilled turkey and cheese.
Yes.
Yeah.
Throw something in the middle, and I also don't want chips or anything with it. I just need some tomato soup.
Yeah.
I'm a dipper.
Yeah, same. And I'll even do, I'll mix it up with like a chicken noodle or whatever, but tomato soup's better.
Yeah, I like a nice thick tomato bisque because I like to take my sandwich on a lap or two.
There you go.
Yeah, if I'm having grilled cheese, especially if there's no meat in it, we're going to need to take a lap around some tomato soup.
Now, how about your cheese or cheeses of choice for your grilled cheese?
Creamy Havarti.
Oh, really? Okay. I'm more of a cheddar man or a Colby Jack situation, but I do love Havarti. I just feel like I have it less often.
I have nothing wrong with a cheddar. If we're going cheddar, I like a sharp cheddar.
So do I.
You know? But yeah, look.
Havarti's nice, though.
You can't go wrong with any kind of cheese, but in the sandwich game for me, it is almost always creamy Havarti.
Okay.
That is a go-to for me on any sandwich. You're making a French dip, guess what?
I believe that's the number one white cheese out there.
It should be.
Yeah.
It should be the number one cheese, period.
I would still give cheddar the nod there, but I could see where you're working.
Also, let me throw this one at you, too.
I just have always preferred the whites.
You know, I love the whites. If you've got some leftover steak or any kind of meat dish, pot roast, whatever you got, right? Grill yourself the two pieces of bread, right? So you get a nice crisp on there. Throw your meat on there. I heat it up in the microwave first. Throw my leftover steak or whatever. Blue cheese crumbles. Boom. Flip that thing.
Mm.
And then get the blue cheese melty. You got to grill first. Otherwise, the blue cheese just goes
bluey. Uh-huh.
So you do a little grilling first. Flip that. And you do a blue cheese, like steak grilled cheese.
Mm.
By the way, you're welcome.
That sounds stellar, sir.
It is. I take my sandwiches seriously. And even notice, you know, what the best part about a grilled cheese is? That it's warm. because cold sandwiches can get bent. I got no time for your cold sandwiches, Buck.
Well, I wouldn't recommend
take your
cold
Jimmy John's,
grilled cheese.
Roll it up real tight and cram it.
But if I'm going to eat lunch here, I wouldn't make myself a grilled cheese at home and then bring it and have it later because it would be bad. I would make myself a cold sandwich at home and bring it here because it would be the same.
It's called heating it up.
You don't want to reheat a grilled cheese.
I'll
You're
reheat
not
a
doing
grilled.
That.
You know what's worse than having something reheated?
A
something
cold
that's
sandwich.
Never heated. You're sweaty.
You
cold
are
cuts.
Missing the marvel, you know, the marvels of a cold sandwich, of cold, a deli sandwich.
Cold sandwiches, whatever. That's the Mountain
there
West.
There are some of the greatest
creations. It's the Mountain
creations.
West of sandwiches. Enjoy
it
your UNLV
not.
Sandwich. We play big boy sandwich games
it's
over
It's not
here.
About big and small. It's different sandwiches for different occasions.
We play in the Big Ten. We play the Ohio State of sandwiches.
Listen, I'm not saying a deli sandwich is better than a... Actually, I am saying a deli sandwich is better than a plain grilled cheese. But different situations for different sandwiches is all I'm saying.
It's Bush League. That's all I'm telling you. It's Bush League. It is also National Licorice Day. It is actually National Day for the 12s, which I didn't know Seahawks fans have their own day.
Who gave them that?
I don't know. Actually, it was started by some group of 12s from Hawaii, of all places.
Okay.
And in honor of Jason Day's Giant Pants and Augusta National, it's National Big Wind Day.
Oh, okay.
I don't know if you've seen how windy it is on that course.
Really windy. They picked a good day for it.
Yeah, and by the way, the course is kicking people's ass left and right.
Yeah.
And every now and then, they'll show the tee box, and they'll get the gust of wind, and you can see the pollen cloud just
shift.
Like a giant wave of locusts just blowing across the fairway. So if you've got allergies... Have fun. Like that visible cloud of pollen is terrifying.
Yeah.
I see that sometimes like out at my house and it's just, I just know.
You know it's going to be a bad
yep,
day.
I know it's going to be for like the next 48 hours, I'm not going to be able to breathe.
Yeah.
Speaking of not being able to breathe, you know, on Tuesday we pulled the body out of the Willamette.
Oh, that's right.
Make that dose because late last night, guess what we found again?
Another body.
Second body, 2 and 3 days. Actually, it wasn't late. I guess it was before noon.
What a body.
But it had been there for a while, so it probably actually was the night before. But around noon, a 911 caller reported seeing a body in the Willamette right off the East Bank near OMSI. The other one, I think, was down by the St. John Bridge on the other side of the Burnside.
Mm-hmm.
That was a little further down. This one was right over by OMSI, which is where there's a little boat rental place there that we always rent a couple boats from during the summer. And apparently there was just a body floating around out there, so they called the sheriff and they were able to recover it. And it does appear to be a man.
Okay.
So we got two men floating in the river. We don't know circumstances. We've yet to identify either one.
And we don't know if there's a connection or not.
No.
We don't, and we don't assume so, at least at this point. Or
I don't know. Okay. Just saying, two bodies in the river. I don't know what's happening, but hey. We're working on 2 and 3 days, so we got a long weekend ahead of us. Let's see if three come up. But I told you, my working theory is there's always bodies cruising around in the Willamette.
I think you're
always
probably right. Yeah, at least body parts.
Well, that's on the coast. You know,
well, that too.
That's on the, between here and in California, we got feet washing up left and right. All right, when we come back, we've got standoff news. We got some weather news. Plenty of stories to get to as In the News rolls on. Primetime here on The Fan.
This is The Fan's Window into Sports. A view into today's top stories. Brought to you by Window Nation. Online at windownation.com.
Oberg from 128 here at the ninth.
There it is.
There we go. That's the way to do it.
That's my Swede. That's Ludwig Åberg. Or is it Auberg?
Oberg?
Oberg?
I think it might be Oberg. Yeah. He's O-bringing it this weekend.
Yeah, because it's with an A. Yeah, he's a rookie, by the way. And he had the low round of the day. Just a nice little 69 there. And he is sitting 2 under, which is 4 shots back of the leaderboard with Homa, DeChambeau, and Scheffler.
Not bad for a first-timer.
No. The debutante, if you will. Go Sweden. This Window into Sports brought to you by Window Nation. Get 50% off all styles of windows. Plus, pay nothing with no interest for 2 full years at windownation.com.
The College Gridiron Reset.
It is called the College Sports Tomorrow Group.
In what world are you coming up with a deal that is going to be double this that gives any motivation to these big boys to come to the table?
Is this new and improved college football or NFL life?
Yes, it becomes professional football.
It basically does.
So
it
the Wild West of the transfer portal and the NIL era are gone.
Talk about it and get the inside story from Portland's sports leader, 1080.
The Big Ten and the SEC, they're not going to play this game.
The Fan.
Who are the good people that we represent? This is McDaniel Reynolds with the Reynolds Defense Firm, and we specialize in just one thing. We represent good people facing DUI charges. So, who are these good people? Our clients are productive members of society. They're folks with integrity, people who know.
I do feel that this song is very much a Sachi. I can see him cruising down, you know,
Sachi.
Some chest meat out. He definitely needs to get some more gold chains if he's going to full embrace the Sachi.
Have you
presence.
Seen this video before? It makes me just want to, like, yeah. I mean, it makes me want to just, like, strut in bell bottoms with sunglasses on.
Oh, yeah. Look, you can say what you will about Travolta. Dude, back in the day, Travolta was the balls. Come on. There wasn't a guy on the planet that, like, in 1979 didn't want to be John Travolta.
Isachi.
He could be Isachi. If you looked up what Isachi should be, it's 1979 John Travolta. All right, we're smack dab in the middle of In the News. We had a little SWAT standoff out in Hillsborough, a little 6 hours.
I missed that. That's just next door to me.
Yeah, right there off of Southeast Washington Street and 7th Avenue. Is that over by you?
Well, no, I mean, it's not. I go to Hillsborough every day to drop my kid off, so it's the town next over. But when SWAT comes through, that's usually something.
Yeah, well, apparently, if you were driving around that area this morning, no go. Yeah, they had to corner off a bunch of side streets there. Started around 3 a.m., a house on, in Washington near 7th Avenue. The SWAT members showed up to go into a home searching for the suspect, and they couldn't find him, and they used what looked like gas or smoke to force him out of the house. The man who barricaded himself inside the house had warrants issued out for his arrest, including a parole violation. Earlier Friday morning, the sheriff's office said the person was inside the home alone and was possibly armed. They have not reported the name of the man that was this morning. I haven't seen any updates on it. But, yeah, I guess for about 6 hours, you know, we had a full-on standoff. And then, we had some tear gas and everything. And, you know, they got the photos out there they brought out. I love that the police have, like, full-on, like, by the way, they have, like, tanks. They're about like the full-on like Brinks armored car, and there's like 25 different cops out there, and apparently they got this jackass. And
I always wonder though about standoff person, like, how do you think that if you just wait long enough they're gonna go away? Like, it's not like a standoff isn't really something you can ever just wait out. So what are we doing?
Remember when Antonio Brown, he had that standoff and it worked out?
Yeah.
Eventually, yeah. I think eventually they went away and they did arrest him. But yeah, he had a standoff.
Yeah,
I'm with you. The standoff guy.
Like, where do you think it's gonna end up?
Well, it usually ends up in suicide, right?
Often does, or suicide or surrender. But you're not like they're not just gonna go away.
I think the problem when you're dealing with that is you're probably insane.
Yeah, I mean there are no cooler heads prevailing.
No, which is why you end up in the standoff to begin with. Yes, I often wonder when the police show up with like multiple SWAT tanks and you've got like 30 officers around you. Maybe you've seen one too many like westerns, like Young Gun style, where you think you're gonna blast your way out of it. But I mean, I don't know. Maybe the idea of going to prison. I luckily I've never been in a standoff situation. I don't plan on being in a standoff.
Yeah, I guess you just probably assume getting what I get out there is gonna be worse than I just don't want to face it yet. Yeah. I don't know.
Oh, I don't. Yeah, I mean, but after 6 hours, I guess he didn't just peacefully surrender. I guess they gassed him out.
Well, true. Yeah. Forcefully surrendered.
Forcefully surrendered. We also have this one too. Gresham police: a teen shot at his girlfriend's family before he kidnapped her.
Oh,
did you see this story?
No, I did not.
17 years old, by the way. Like, holy cow! 17-year-old boy facing charges of kidnapping.
Where did he get the gun?
I don't think it's that hard for people to find.
It isn't. That's kind of my point.
Yeah.
17-year-old shouldn't really have access to guns.
No, nor should he be kidnapping anyone.
Nope, that too.
But authorities received a call from the teen's girlfriend who had been taken against her will while she was working. This according to Gresham police. She said the boyfriend then shot at the family. I guess the family were like, no, you
can't take her.
You're not taking her. And he was like, yeah, we can.
Well, with this thing, I can, yeah.
Yeah, so he started shooting at him. And then the police began chasing the teen's car as it drove out of Gresham's. Or out of Gresham. They found the car near Dodge Park. I guess that's out in rural Clackamas County.
Okay.
But when a deputy tried to make a stop, he cheesed it. He gassed it and got out of there. Chased the car for about 6 miles. And then it drove off a roadway near Barlow High School, where officials report that the teen then fled into a nearby wooded area, which again goes to your point.
How do you think it's going to end?
Well, which is worse? Let me ask you this. Which is worse? You have the standoff in your house, or you flee into the woods, the scraggly woods. Is not sure which one is worse.
I mean, I guess at least, like, there have been people who have escaped on manhunts, right? Like, I mean,
yeah,
not
I mean,
really. You're not, 17? It's not ending well. Yeah. It's not like you were prepared for this life on the run.
Yeah. The teen was taken into custody after SWAT showed up. The victim was transported to a local hospital, minor injuries. They got some cuts and scrapes running through the scraggly woods. And now the teen faces charges of attempted murder, you know, he shot at the family, kidnapping, and several other crimes, including domestic violence. Although, you know, no offense, but after you've kidnapped and attempted murder, do you really care about the domestic violence charge?
No.
I think that's one of those. You're like, yeah. I think the kidnapping and the attempted murder, I think those are the two big ones.
Yeah.
Lesson to be learned. Don't do those.
Don't
barricade yourself into your house. Just come out and surrender. Also, don't kidnap your girlfriend when you're 17. That's a bad idea. And don't shoot at the family. That's not good either. That's all kinds of bad.
Yeah.
What's our last one that we got here? Oh, yeah, we've got we had a kidnapping story. Now, should we have an attempted kidnapping?
Sure.
Manchard,
well, that means it didn't happen, which is good.
Yeah, it didn't happen. The boy was able to avoid this. But this occurred near Jacob Winsmer Elementary and Stoller Middle School Complex.
Is that out in like Dundee area?
Out in Washington County. I don't know that area that well.
I only imagined like Dundee because Stoller Middle School. I wondered if it's the same as like Stoller Winery, which is out that way.
Yeah, it's out like Beaverton area.
Okay.
I know out that direction. But they said he wasn't enrolled in the Beaverton School District, but it was in that area.
Huh.
The man approached a boy Thursday about 5:20. Said the boy is not enrolled in Beaverton School District, but he was walking home after spending time with friends at the elementary school. So he's probably there on the playground. You know, you're doing some sliding. Maybe you got some merry-go-round time. Maybe doing some underdogs on the swings. You're having a grand old time. And he's walking home, and the man was near the bus pickup lanes at the Stoller Middle School when he falsely stated that he was there to pick the boy up. The boy didn't recognize
the
man.
Dude, that's creepy. Yeah. Yeah, I'm here for him. No, you're not.
No, it's no. Wait till it gets creepier. So the boy didn't recognize the man. He was able to run away, and he returned safely home. The boy described the man. This is where it gets double creepy. So be on the lookout if you're out in that area. The man was in his 70s.
Okay.
He had a 2 to 3 inch long beard. And let me tell you right now, anyone with a 3 inch beard.
Not to be trusted.
Not to be trusted. Especially if there's some gray in that beard. That's dicey at best. He was wearing a t-shirt, a hat with an American flag on it, and large Pit Viper style sunglasses.
What?
Yeah. And you would think that he'd
be. Is this John Daly?
You would think he was driving a windowless van. Nay. I say nay. Silver Mercedes SUV, which is a total upset. If I told you,
yeah.
70 years old, big-ass long beard, Pit Viper glasses, American flag hat.
I bet you'd have like a Buick LeSabre or something like that, maybe.
I'm going 100% van.
Yeah.
That's a van. Probably, and if it's not windowless, that van has mini blinds on. But no, silver SUV, Washington County Sheriff's Office.
And a Mercedes, also an upset.
Yeah, working with the Beaverton School District. They're going to review surveillance footage, and anyone with information about the man is asked to contact the sheriff's office.
I mean, the part that is really alarming to me is it's not like a parent who's estranged. Like it sounds like this guy is waiting for essentially a rogue kid to go by that he could claim as like he had a right to take with. It bothers.
It's no
bothers
good.
Big time.
That and pit vipers out in public over a certain age. Yeah. You can't do that.
I mean,
that's not.
Like, really, no one should wear pit vipers, but that's a whole other discussion.
If you're a bro, I get it. You know, if your name is Gunner and you play for the Orioles.
Yeah, baby!
I understand. Hey, pit viper it up. But Cool has a cutoff, and look, it's before 70.
Yeah.
You can't be wearing pit vipers.
And you can't be kidnapping people.
No, you can't do that. Hey, at least he didn't shoot at the family, so, you know.
Let's not give him any extra credit points.
So if you see that man, if you see a man in his
70s.
So
he got away, though.
Yeah, the kid got away.
No, but the guy, did they apprehend him?
No.
He got away, too?
He got away, too.
Okay.
So.
Not for long, scumbag.
Yeah, we're looking out for you. So, big white beard, American flag hat, pit vipers, silver SUV, Mercedes. People are saying that's out in the Bethany area, by the way.
Yeah, I looked it up. It looks.
Just north of Beaverton?
Yeah.
Be on the lookout for that. All right, when we come back, the Hot 5 at 5, and then Joey Harrington will join us at 5:30 for his weekly stop. You're listening to Primetime here on The Fan.
It's time for High Stakes, a tasty look at clutch performances and the biggest games, served up by Steakadelphia.
With all the work I put in since I was a kid starting basketball, and you know, like all the coaches, great coaches I have, and all of my family that's around me every day. I think it's really important into what made me like the person I am today and the basketball player I am today. And with that being said, I just make it official that I'm declaring for the 2024 NBA draft.
Future Portland Trailblazer?
Maybe. Huh? Projected top three,
Alex
maybe the number
Sarr,
one pick, yeah.
A 7'1" Frenchman, dare I say the next Wemby? Probably not, but...
Yeah, Wemby feels really generational, but, you know, 7'1", and...
He's 7'1", and he's French, therefore he's the next Wemby.
Yeah.
And the Blazers could be drafting in the top three, depending on how the ping pong balls drop. So what's at stake? Drafting a 7'1" Frenchman. High Stakes brought to you by Steakadelphia, featuring authentic, crazy good cheesesteaks full of cheesy goodness that are served warm, by the way, Buckley. Visit Steakadelphia on Southeast 59th and Powell, or their new location, Southwest 103rd and Canyon Road in Beaverton.
I like warm sandwiches.
Hey, it's Dusty. When my family and I are in a time crunch or just want a delicious meal, our go-to is always Victorico's Mexican food. My favorite is the Northwest Burrito. My kids love the rolled tacos. With several area locations, it's easy to pick up Victorico's. Order online now at victoricos.com or on the mobile app.
Join 1080 The Fan and Odyssey as we all do our one thing. Together, millions of things for our planet. This Earth Day, we're teaming up with Free Geek for our Tech Now Drive. On April 19th, bring your unused laptops, tablets, and mobile phones to Washington Square. Free Geek's goal is to divert technology that would otherwise
welcome in just after 5 o'clock on a perfect spring Friday. Absolutely gorgeous, and tomorrow is the day you want to get outside and do something. Woke up to a little showers this morning, but now I think we're in the high 60s. Tomorrow we're going to be in the 70s, and then the Sunday we got some showers coming back, some cooler temperatures, and then supposed to be back in the 50s. But for that brief window right now, it's like the perfect temperature. You get like that 68 to 72 degree day this time of year. It's not a better place to be in America. Wonderful. Joey Harrington will join us here in about 25, 30 minutes or so for his weekly chat, and then we'll get into Club 1080. We do have some more conjoined twins talk. I don't know if you saw this. But
do we?
Yeah. Yeah. We're like, we've got animal news. We've got conjoined twins.
Well, yeah, that's if Isaac were a conjoined twin having relations.
Reading the paragraph like, aha!
We got some pickleball news and the new craze in drugs. There's two things that are sweeping the drug scene right now, and I'll let you pick out which one's worse. One involves snakes and one involves horses. All of that in the club. But right now, let's get to the Hot 5 at 5.
Oh. Hot topics, hot opinions.
Oh, golly, I'm hot today.
And hot air. It's time for the Hot 5 at 5.
It's hot.
The Hot 5 at 5 on primetime with Isaac and Sue.
No, I mean it. That's very hot.
The Hot 5 at 5 with Isaac and Sue. Brought to you on the fan by Victorico's Mexican Food, the most popular burrito spot in Oregon. Online at victoricos.com. Number 5.
Go to the world of college basketball. Kentucky has found their man. It turns out Mark Pope.
He's your man.
Well, not anymore.
Not anymore.
He was our guy. Mark Pope, the BYU coach for the last 5 years, he will be the next coach at Kentucky. And apparently Kentucky fans are not happy about it. I love the fact that a man who was a... he is a former Kentucky player. He was a captain on the...
One of their own.
One of their own.
A champion.
A champion, captain of the 1996 team, has been a solid coach at BYU. Apparently, Kentucky fan was so pissed off about it, they've just been blowing up anyone that will listen. They're like flooding phone calls, emails to the athletic director, the university president.
They're really unhappy.
Yeah, which makes you wonder, if you're Mark Pope, I mean, I understand coming home, but you might get a little glimpse into why people didn't want that job in the first place. Also, clinging the big man out of UConn, Filipowski. No surprise there. Both of those will enter the NBA draft. And then, as you mentioned, the Sarr kid, the 7'1 Frenchman.
Alexandre Sarr.
Yeah, projected to be a top three pick and possibly future Portland Trailblazer.
Number 4.
Rashee Rice, former Kansas City chief receiver. He surrendered to police today after a warrant was issued for his arrest yesterday. He's going to cooperate with it. Turns out he was driving 119 miles an hour in the Lamborghini when it crashed.
Yeah, well, we've seen the video, or at least like the back end of the video, and yeah, it was way too fast.
Yeah, so he's cooperating. Kansas City has not said what they're going to do. No discipline from the NFL right now, but you got about 3 days, you know, until like the league year starts, and you actually kind of have to make a decision on what you want to do. Do you suspend him now? Do you keep him away from team activities? But he did surrender, and will now. We'll see what happens. Doesn't sound like Kansas City's in a hurry to make a decision on this.
No,
he's
and
a
it's
young player. They're going to try to kick this thing down the road.
Yeah, I think they're going to kick it down the road. And additionally, if it causes him headaches, they're saying that some of the stuff he did in there could be make his contract voidable. So it might not hurt them if they decide to follow.
Well, and there was weed in the car, and it's just
allegations. There could have been weapons and other things.
Weapons.
But
it's a bad look.
Number 3.
Not a lot of finished games going on right now in the Major League. A lot of stuff early on. We got the Twins and the Tigers, 1-0 Tigers right now. That's only in the second. Giants-Rays, that's in the top of the fifth. The Rays up 2-1 on Bucks-Giants. Our Orioles taken in the shorts right now by the surprisingly 8-3 Milwaukee Brewers. They're at 4-0. That's in the fifth. Rockies-Jays, Rockies up 4-2. And then the Angels in the top of the fourth up 4-0 on the Bravos. The Kansas City Royals and the New York Mets, that's in the fifth. Mets up 3-1 in that. And then one of the nightcaps we got is the Cubbies making their way. I think Seattle's now got like a 6 or 7 game homestand. They're going to be up at T-Mobile tonight as the Mariners try to get off the schneid here. 5-8 on the year as they will take on the Cubbies. And then the nightcap, we got Padres-Dodgers from Chavez Ravine. So should be a good one tonight on the diamond. The Yankees and the Guardians postponed due to weather.
Number 2.
Actually, kind of a big one tonight in the NBA is we're down to the nitty-gritty here. If you look at some of these standings, there is a ton of playoff seeding, including...
A lot of jockeying,
including maybe your Portland Trailblazers as their season mercifully comes down. Well, you know, ping-pong balls. You know,
ping-pong balls matter.
Ping-pong balls matter. I mean, when you look at the standings here, let me pull it up. I want to say they're only a game back. Where are my Blazers at? 21-59. You know, they're only a game back of San Antonio. San Antonio is 20-60. And the Charlotte Hornets, also 20-60. You know, that clutch loss that Charlotte had the other night, it's going to come back and haunt you. They understood the assignment.
Yeah, and then you won the next night too, right? It was the Blazers won two in a row that did not need to happen.
But you look around the league in games that actually matter. Milwaukee and New York, there's only a game separating those between the 2 and the 3 seed. Cleveland and the Magic for the 4 and 5, and throw Indiana in that mix. They're all within a game of each other for 4, 5, 6. Philadelphia sitting right there, only a game back of what the play-in would be in that 8-9 game between Miami and Chicago. So there is a lot of jockeying to go on here in the last couple days of the NBA season. And then number one, the Masters. The course playing much, much harder.
So it was, I mean, we know it rained yesterday, but then I guess the sun came right out. It pulled up all the moisture, and then the wind backed that up and pulled out even more moisture. And the guys had to battle the wind and, like, dry, tight greens. It was rough.
Yeah, in fact, I think the low score, because yesterday we had a couple of buttery 67s. I think the low score today was my man Ludwig.
Yeah, well, Bryson went 65 yesterday, 7 under. And, yeah, lowest score today, only 3 under.
Yeah, was it is it Auberg?
Oberg, I think they're saying. Even it starts with an A, but it's at the little O over the top.
Yeah, it's mildly confusing, those damn Swedes. Yeah, he shot 69, so he's sitting there at 2 under. But a nice little leaderboard. You got Max Homa at 6, Scottie Scheffler at 6 under, Bryson DeChambeau. Those are your co-leaders after 2. Some other notables there. Colin Morikawa is sitting there at 3, Cameron Davis at 3. Cameron Smith at 1 under, scrolling down, Danny Willett at 1 under, bunch of guys including Xander Schauffele at even par, Lucas Glover, Tiger Woods finished +1, so he will make the cut for the 24th straight time. That's a record. Koepka at +2, scrolling down, Phil at +4, Rory at +4, he had a rough day, shot a 77. The cut line is actually going to be at +6. By the way, Justin Thomas with an absolute heartbreaker. I think he was +7 on his final 4 holes, including a double bogey on 18 to actually miss the cut by 1 shot. So Justin Thomas will not be playing into the weekend.
Oh, I just pulled it up. It's worse than that. He on 15, 16, 17, 18 went double, double, single bogey, double bogey. So he had 3 doubles and a single in the final four holes to miss the cut by 1.
Some others that have missed it: Zach Johnson, former Masters winner; Wyndham Clark, who was kind of talking some smack about Bryson DeChambeau.
I got 54 holes to catch up.
Yeah, he went 73-78. Sergio, who I actually had a little bet on to finish in the top 10, he also, 72-79, will not be playing over the weekend. Bubba Watson, Freddie Couples, some others. Dustin Johnson did not make
Victor
the cut.
Victor Hovland.
Yeah, so a lot of big names will not be. Yeah, Spieth won't be playing. So kind of a rough day out at Augusta. And so I guess they're saying that the wind shouldn't be this bad. The conditions are going to get warmer and the course is going to get harder. But they say this should be the last day of the wind quite like this.
The other thing, I mean, they couldn't do anything to make it easier today. But I think when days like this happen, the grounds crew or the greenskeepers and all that, they can make it so it's a little bit more favorable tomorrow, and I bet that's what we see.
Yeah. All right, we come back. We'll talk a little NFL draft, and then Joey Harrington will join us at 5:30. You got primetime here on The Fan.
The Caitlin Sensation.
The Hawkeyes are headed back to the Final Four. Galactic greatness from Caitlin Clark.
What does this mean for women's sports?
Does this translate to the WNBA? How does the tournament capitalize on this? Like, is this truly a launching point, or is it a one-off because of Caitlin Clark?
Talk about it and get the inside story from Portland's sports leader, 1080.
She is a force multiplier unlike anything we've seen in the game.
NFL draft coming up in just a couple of weeks. And I saw today that the NFL said they're only inviting 15 players. 15 to 20, actually.
I saw that, too, only because I saw a headline about Bo Nix not being invited.
Yeah, so they're saying that they don't want any more than 20. So they said they were going to invite 15 to 20, although some people turned them down. Like, J.J. McCarthy apparently said no, he doesn't want to come. So I guess what they're trying to do this year is they're trying to eliminate the green room. The green room fall, because every year we see this. It's the Aaron Rodgers theory, right? Where someone comes to the NFL draft and they just sit there that's supposed to be a top 10 pick and they fall sometimes even into the second round. It happens every year.
We saw it happen with a number of guys before. Oh, and then it's especially embarrassing when you have to come back the next day.
Yeah, every year, right, we hear about, oh, this guy is a surefire, you know, top 15 pick, and he goes a tumbling. Because remember, when it comes to the NFL draft, we can speculate all we want and, oh, everyone in university likes this guy, but we don't really know. Like, people play this stuff very, very close to their chest, especially with these quarterbacks, right? We have a belief that we know that we're going to see potentially four quarterbacks in the first four or five picks, right? Seemingly J.J. McCarthy being one of those, and then Bo Nix and Michael Penix being the other two that everyone says, hey, these are going to be first-round picks. In fact, I've seen Penix maybe going like 13 overall to the Raiders. Well, apparently the NFL doesn't agree with
that.
They
don't want to roll the dice.
They don't want to roll the dice. So Nix and Penix are not going to be invited, but McCarthy is. And this is where I find it interesting, and I want to talk to Joey about this. Yep. Joey Harrington will join us next. I'm not saying that I watch all of J.J. McCarthy's games, right? I always put this qualifier on it. There is a big difference. I watch a lot of college football. I always say that I feel more comfortable speaking on the Pac-12 than I do anything else because I watch more Pac-12 football than anything else. I watched every game that Bo Nix played when he was at Oregon. Never missed a game. I watched 75% of Michael Penix's snaps at UW. I try to watch... I do watch every Oregon game, I watch every Oregon State game, and I watch every Washington game, I'd say
for the most part that you can.
For the most part that I can, right? Even if I miss a game, I try to go back, and sometimes I'll skip through it, you know, do the little skip ahead button. But I watch those. And over the course of watching those, I feel like I get a pretty good grasp on the Pac-12. And then from a national standpoint, I watched Michigan play 10 times over the last 2 years. And so I feel like I have at least put my eyeballs on J.J. McCarthy, and I think J.J. McCarthy is a fine quarterback. But never once when I was watching J.J. McCarthy did I think I was watching a top 10 quarterback, let alone I there was a borderline first-round quarterback. He went into this year as a borderline first-year quarterback. And what I keep hearing about J.J. McCarthy, about why he's a top 5 pick, is because he's a winner.
That's a little weird, isn't it?
It makes no sense to me whatsoever that you keep hearing he's a winner. Jake Browning was a winner. Ken Dorsey was a winner.
So, you know who else? Like Greg McElroy, AJ McCarron, guys like that who never lost in high school, in college. So what? That doesn't make you a good pro quarterback.
It's so strange that we're not talking about much about McCarthy other than he wins. In fact, the one that always bewilders me is the game against Penn State. He didn't throw a pass in the second half.
And you might even say about him, it's not so much that he's a winner, he's a not going to take you out of the game and lose it for you. And which so, is like not
which,
even...
Which is fine. I understand there's an element to that.
Well, there's virtue to that, but that's not a selling point. Yeah.
And this notion of, well, look, only a real competitor and only a real winner would let a coach take the ball out of his hands. What? Like, we're now giving him credit for not complaining about not throwing a single pass in the second half against Penn State? I find that weird. And when you look at a lot of quarterbacks that have gone on to be very successful in the NFL, it's this weird double-edged sword because, yes, quarterback is the hardest position in all of sports. And when you have a good one, it makes everything else better. And if you have a bad one, see the New York Jets, you can be good all around. But if you don't have a quarterback, you're not going anywhere. But this idea that you win or lose simply based on the quarterback, especially at the collegiate level, it's foolish. Go back and look it up. Tom Brady was 20-5 in his 2 years at Michigan and never won the Big Ten. Tom Brady actually got benched at one point while he was at Michigan. He split time at quarterback. By the way, he was never even a Big Ten second team selection. He was twice Big Ten all honorable mention. Patrick Mahomes went 13-19 as a starter at Texas Tech. His best year was 7-5.
The point is, it's not the W's and the L's that they put up. It's what they're going to do with a new team, a new system, with the physical talents they have.
John Elway, 20-23. Never went to a bowl game. Josh Allen, 16-11. Peyton Manning never won the SEC. Started 4 years at Tennessee, never won the SEC. Do you know what they did the year after he left?
They won the championship.
They won the national championship with T. Martin.
Yep.
So is T. Martin a winner and Peyton Manning's not? This stuff just now, if you watch the film and you think that J.J. McCarthy is an enormous talent and you love his pocket presence and he delivers all the footballs and all of this, that's fine.
And I think there's also virtue to if you line up three quarterbacks and you're like, man, they all have similar mobility and great arm strength and accuracy, but this one guy, he's got the intangibles, like he's the winner.
Yeah.
But you got to do the other things first. Check the physical boxes.
Yeah, as someone points out on the Vancouver Ford text line, you know who's one of the great winners in college football history? Tim Tebow. Vince Young single-handedly beat, at the time, what many people, myself included, thought might be the best college football team of all time. And that Texas team was okay. I think Michael Huff was on that team. I mean, they had some talent. Might have been, was it Cedric Benson was his running back? It wasn't Ricky.
That sounds right.
I think it was Cedric Benson.
It definitely was not Ricky, but yeah, I think
there
Sam
was
Benson.
Some talent there, but make no mistake about it, Vince Young single-handedly slayed USC.
Yeah, oh, yeah.
Was Vince Young any good in the NFL? Nope. Like this notion that you win, it is so strange to me. But at the same time, I don't want a quarterback that can't lead a team. I don't want a quarterback that
can't. Of course, but that can't be the only thing he does is be a good locker room guy.
Yeah. And so when the J.J. McCarthy stuff is just fascinating.
It's perplexing.
Because I don't, and maybe this is just a media narrative, and so maybe this is just, you know, we're getting pushed this direction by
agents and
marketers that we're being told this, and then behind the scenes,
or even smokescreens from teams who want you to think they like him instead of somebody else.
And behind the scenes, you know, NFL people think a different way. Maybe he's a guy that goes tumbling, or maybe NFL people behind the scenes be like, trust me, this guy may not show everything, but when it comes to it, we believe that he is more Tom Brady. Yeah, he wasn't asked to do a ton, because I guess this could go the other way too, in that Michigan didn't ask him to do a lot. Because there are throws. If you go look at their two playoff games.
Sure, it's possible that he has more there than we've seen.
He's got some phenomenal, like I see people that break down film on Twitter, and I think Dan Orlovsky does a really good job of this. Matt Miller does a really good job of this. And there are some throws that you watch him make in those games, you're like, okay, that's a big time throw. Right, five-step drop, feel the pressure, step up in the pocket, look the safety the other way, delivered one across the middle, big-time throw, and you're like, that's amazing. But
you don't have 30 of them.
You don't. And so this becomes the question with J.J. McCarthy. What did they say about the only person that could hold Michael Jordan under 20 was?
Phil Jackson.
Or in college.
Oh, Dean Smith,
right? And so is this a case of J.J. McCarthy being held back because it's Jim Harbaugh? And Harbaugh's like,
refuse to let you lose this game by turning it over or something?
And there could be an element. Like, I didn't believe in this with Justin Herbert. Like, I was one of those guys that when I watched Herbert play in college where I was like, I need more. It's too inconsistent. They don't rely on him enough. I was not in love with Justin Herbert. And you heard that was a product of their offense, the philosophy. They didn't want to take risks, and they kind of neutered him, and he didn't necessarily have great receivers around him. That's not the case with McCarthy. But clearly with Justin Herbert, he was being held back by his coaches and his offensive scheme. Is this a case with Michigan where they're like, hey, man, I know, you know, that you've got all these capabilities, but it's just not what we're going to do. We're going to run the ball 40 times. We're going to play defense, and I don't care that you have the ability to do this. Is that the case, or is this one of those where he is more Ken Dorsey than he is Tom Brady?
Yeah.
And I think for all the talk of Bo Nix and Penix and even Drake May being risky guys to hang your hat on, I do not think that there is a riskier player in the draft than J.J. McCarthy.
And you have less to look at. You have less body work to fall back on.
And he's being talked about like he is this.
People have talked about him as number two.
I don't see it. But again, I'm not a quarterback. I don't know exactly what that makeup needs to be. I know there's a lot of intangibles there. I think I need to see a little bit more. When we come back, we'll ask a man who actually played the position, who, by the way, might be able to relate to this because, you know, when Joey was coming out, Joey was a winner. Joey was that guy. had physical tools, but the big thing about Joey is he was a gamer. He was a winner. I'll be interested to see what his take on evaluating NFL quarterbacks like J.J. McCarthy. That when we come back here, though, Buck with SportsCenter.
joins us each and every Friday, normally with Asace and myself. But Asace is down at Augusta, so we'll be doing a two-man show today with one Joseph Harrington and myself. Joey, how's it going, my friend?
I spent that introduction trying to Asace, I-S, because there's no E on the end, so it can't be Asace if there's no E at the end.
Well, I don't know if you're aware, but he's rebranded. He's rebranded, you know, as Asace now. Like, we're on the YouTube channels now and like Twitch and whatnot, and one of the graphic guys, apparently, no one can spell Isaac. So apparently someone spelled it Asace. So he's decided to roll with it and make himself some sort of mysterious, Italian character, the designer that is Asace.
Got it. You know, I heard there was an Italian designer who died today.
Really?
Yeah, it wasn't Asace, but it just made me, it was like, who's the, it rhymes, I don't know, I'm going off topic here. Anyway, where is Asace?
Well, now that he's Asace and he's a big deal, he's headed down to the Masters for the second time.
Okay.
Yeah, I know.
So let's examine this. How does, because I was literally having this conversation with somebody yesterday. Mm-hmm. I was lucky enough to go to the Masters 02, 03, 04, and 07.
I love that you've been so many times, you're not certain of the dates. You're like, I was fortunate enough to go for 12 straight years.
Well, put a cork in it. That's not the point. The point is during that time, tickets were, I was given tickets the first year, and then it's like, then I bought tickets the next year because I was in the, I was in the NFL and doing fine. Yeah. But they weren't stratosphere type prices. I think it was like, if I remember correctly, it was like $1,500 for all 4 days.
Ah.
It wasn't bad. It was like, okay, that's a lot of money. Yeah. I get it. Now, what is it's like? It's like $10,000.
Is it really?
I mean, it is. I think it's like $1,500 or $2,500 a day.
Jeez, and that
to
it,
go.
And is that through like the lottery? Because I've never been to the Masters.
That's resale. That's like the resale sites. Okay. You know, if like everything with the Masters, if you actually are lucky enough to be there and purchase it at, face value, it's like $1.50 for an egg salad, right? Yeah. The tickets will be fine. But it's the demand that has gone so crazy. So my point is, how does, and maybe Asace is the answer, how does a local sports talk radio show host have the disposable income, let's put it at those prices, to afford a $10,000 ticket to the Masters?
You said it yourself. The answer is he's Asace, and that's how this happens. No, this is the magic of this stupid radio program we've been doing for 20 years. Like, this is how, like, the years ago we did the Worldwide Weasel Tour. And it's like, we had, I think it was George Lopez. We had, the comedian George Lopez?
Yeah.
So he was performing at one of the places around out of the Keller or something. So we had Lopez on. He's a big golfer, right? And I think it was like the Portland Golf Club. He called us from the Portland Golf Club, which is kind of a flex, right? He's like, teeing off here at the, Portland Golf Club. Or it might've been Waverly, one of the two. And we were like, how did that happen? And Lopez was like, I'm George Lopez. It's like, this is what happens. kind of doing a bit or whatever. And he basically was like, you wish you were George Lopez. And so Asace was like, I bet we could do that. And Lopez was like, yeah, right. He basically taunted Rop into being like, good luck. And that's what started the Weasel Tour. So Rop got off the phone with him. We finished the interview, and Rop was like, screw that guy. He's like, watch this. He's like, I guarantee we have a listener. So he solicited, shamelessly, by the way, he solicited a listener to take us out to whatever it was, Portland or Waverly. And then, like, offers just kind of started pouring in. And next thing we played Waverly, we played Portland, we played Oswego Lake. We got all these things, and we called it the Worldwide Weasel Tour. And that, I think it was Lopez was like, I just weaseled my way on
but you have to be George Lopez. And so I think that's when Rop realized the power of the radio. And so he weaseled his way on to Augusta a number of years ago. I think he just solicited. He was like, hey, it's like someone has to
anybody
know.
Anybody want to take me to the Masters?
Yeah, pretty much. And this guy, we now call him Masters Pete. Masters Pete, he was friends with a guy who was like best friends with the longtime University of Georgia, like tennis coach. The guy was like a legendary, he'd been at Georgia for like 40 years, right? He was the Dr. Jack Ramsey.
The crown stroke.
Yeah. Of Georgia tennis. And through that, like Rop got tickets, or like he didn't get tickets. He got a badge for, I think, Thursday. It was either Thursday or Friday, just the one day. And that started the legend of Masters Pete. And so this time we have Masters Pete and we have Byron Masters, because we had another guy who married someone whose family inherited some badges somehow. There was like a congressman involved or whatnot. And he went to Rob and he's like, he's like, I don't really care. He's like, I don't go every day. Do you want to go one of the days? And Rob was like, yes. What about Sunday? He's like, sure. So he got a badge on Sunday and he's flying down there. I think he's playing golf for 3 days and then he'll go to the Masters on Sunday. It's kind of shit.
He should be doing story time. Yes. I mean, that wasn't that the whole premise of me coming on?
Yes.
Like, you know, just to tell these outlandish, like worldwide weasel stories. But now apparently he is, not only has he surpassed George Lopez, but he's surpassed story time. He needs to sing his own theme song.
Except I'm guessing, I mean, the amount of things that you have gotten to do, like the world of the NFL quarterback, it's like, I always say, like, when you are an incredibly good-looking woman, like, you don't have an idea how the real world works. Like, it's just, they're like, oh my God, everyone is so nice, and everything is discounted, and everything is free, and I'm like, yeah, that's the hot girl discount. Like, the world doesn't work like that. We had someone that worked here once that did our updates, who was a very attractive gal. And came from a family of money. So it was like, it was a double dip in that she was very wealthy and didn't really understand how wealthy she was. Her grandfather started like STP motor oil, like that kind of money.
Oh.
Yeah. So she came from that money and was very, very attractive. And she had this weird idea that the world was much different. Like no one was ever mean to her. There was never any struggle or like, you know, paying bills and whatnot. And I feel like when you're an NFL quarterback, to some extent, it's a little bit, doors just open for you. I don't even think you have to weasel as an NFL quarterback. Like, you didn't weasel your way onto the Masters like Rob did. I'm sure that was just presented to you.
The first year. Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Yeah.
No, we've had this discussion before, because this came up in around the discussion of which professional sports event would you most like to go to?
Yes.
And we were going down the list. And you're like, well, what about the Super Bowl? I was like, yeah, I've been to that. Okay. NBA finals. Yeah. Okay. I've been to that. World Series. Oh yeah, I was, you know, Aaron, you know, ALCS Aaron Boone, yeah. You know. Okay, World Cup, fine. Yeah, no, I was sitting there when Zidane headbutted the guy. Like, you're right. Like this, and that's kind of the craziness, and I think having the, I don't know if perspective is the right word, but I left that life, yeah. Right? When I hung him up, I was like, I don't want anything to do with that. And it's funny looking back on that now. You know what? Okay, here's I was in, we just got back from Italy, and I got a text message from, like, just out of the blue. Some guy was like, hey, I do memorabilia signings. Do you, and there's a company in Detroit that wants you to come out and sign some stuff. And I was like, what the hell? Like, I'm so far removed. And I was like, nah, I'm not going to call this guy back. This must be some sort of joke. And, and so he, you know, sends another message, you know, hey, just following up. I was like, okay, I guess I'll you know, send me some email information. And sure enough, there's a, I was like, why would you want me? He's like, hey, what's old was new again. And like, you know, 20 years, people forget. And now it's, you know, you're retro, you're vintage. And, you know, we'd like to have you out for a signing. Like, okay, sure. You know, just kind of falls in your lap. And I was like, hey, well, you know, if we're going to do one in Detroit, I figure we might as well do one in Eugene or something, right? He's like, oh, that's a great idea. Let me send you a contract for a two-show deal. I was like, okay, I guess we're going to do that. So, yeah, things do kind of fall in your lap sometimes, right, even after you try to remove yourself.
Yeah, it's the ultimate backstage pass. I'm NFL quarterback, elite model. I think those are the two ultimate, like, backstage pass. There's like nothing that one of those, if you're one of those people, there's really nothing that you can't get yourself into. People just,
what if there was a couple that was an NFL quarterback and an elite model?
Yeah, it's called Tom Brady and Giselle.
Oh wait, that happens already.
I think that happens a lot.
Like, what are we talking about right now? I don't know, you know where we are.
I think we're talking about privilege. I think we're talking about Asace's privilege.
Asace, Rop. That's Asace. Right. What a weasel he is. That's
yeah,
right.
Weaseling his way on to Augusta National. Yeah, like when you're a local radio host, like you get like a weird little, like your weasel powers are like at like 10%. Like if an NFL quarterback is like 90, the hot model is more like 98. The radio host from Portland, it's like 8%, but sometimes 8% is enough to get you a 1-day badge at the Masters.
Hey, you know, a 1-day badge at the Masters is more than 92% of the people out there get.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a heck of an experience.
Well, you talked about like removing yourself from, and it made me think of this. I was reading a story today. I think it was in the Atlantic. It was about Charles Tillman, Peanut Tillman, the Bears DB, and how he's the FBI agent now, which is
busy.
Yeah, he's an FBI guy, which is kind of strange. Like you go from,
well, that explains a lot, because he was probably hiding in plain sight when I threw the ball at him and he intercepted it so many times. I think I threw five picks at Soldier Field.
Yeah.
God, that makes sense.
I mean, he was a really good player. Like I was hanging out with a couple weeks back. I was hanging out with Nick Reed, former Duck and Bear. And he's a stealth bomber pilot. Like, you're like, oh my gosh. Like the
Nick Reed is a pilot.
Yeah. Nick Reed is a stealth fighter pilot. Like he lives up in Tacoma and like did a flyover of Eugene. Yeah. He flies the stealth bomber.
Yeah. I need to get a ride on that thing.
That's what I said. And believe me,
that is the next weasel tour.
Yeah. Believe me.
Let's get a ride on the stealth bomber.
I was pushing hard, and quite frankly, I'm not certain I was met with the openest of arms, but I'm not giving up on that. Like that was one of those. I did a lot of I was a big Top Gun fan, and I'm kind of a military plane junkie. And like, I used to build models, and like, I was like, hint. And I was like, I always wanted to fly in a fighter jet, but I'm too big, so they won't let me in the cockpit. Hint, stealth bomber bigger than a fight. Hello, Nick. Like, what are we?
Nothing. Crickets.
Yeah. Like, what are we doing here, bud? You know, now we had been heavily drinking, but still it was like, I was leaning into it pretty heavy. And, I'm not certain if it's like tipping over a Coke machine. I'm not going to do it in one motion. I feel like I have to rock it a little bit, but
yeah,
I think that needs to happen. But yeah, he had a you know, his secondary career. And so the article was talking about how Tillman is trying to help athletes have the second act, and how so many guys, when they step away from it, it sounds like when we've talked many times, you were ready and wanted to step away from it. Most guys don't. And when they do step away from it, they really struggle with depression and purpose and meaning in their life. And it can be pretty dark.
Oh, I wanted to step away from it. And I knew that I was going to have a second act, and I still struggled with depression and meaning. And yeah, and we've talked about this before.
Yeah.
Like, it's real.
Yeah.
And it's not just real for the people who have the rug pulled out from under them. Like it's real for, you know, for anybody who has been in that world.
Yeah.
But we don't need to go down the dark, that topic. We just need to talk about what you should do. Here's our rehabilitation plan.
Yeah.
We need to find anybody who is retired who is in that dark space, and we need to get them into a weasel tour.
Exactly.
We need to create, it's like a Make-A-Wish for, no, that's a really bad, this is a really bad idea. We're flushing it out. It's like, and now it's like, no, that's a horrible idea go, now that I'm thinking
we
about
go
it.
To the public and we're like, we desperately need you to raise funds for ex-famous athletes that are no longer getting to do really cool things.
No, I'm not talking about getting to really cool things. Those guys can do, you know, can do it on their own. I'm talking about the guys that are struggling, that, you know, find some purpose.
It's tough.
Just give them a little, you know, a little boost in their life. Give them a little purpose.
Yeah, I mean, I think you
see. That's not as horrible an idea as it sounded a minute ago.
You see it with anyone that's in like a high pressure situation. I know I hate doing the wartime analogy, but it's the same thing with people that are in the military. It's very regimented. It's your entire life. It's what you do for years and years and years. And then all of a sudden you're done and all of that goes away and the structure and the brotherhood and all that. And there's a lot of people that are, you know, take the PTSD and the war stuff aside. That's a whole other ball game, but just people struggle with that. Again, people struggle to find purpose when your whole life has been that for God knows how many years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm going to leave it there because I figure that we need a commercial. Yeah. And if I continue to expand on that, then all of our sponsorship and the entire segment is done.
All right. We come
and
back.
You're never going to get to the, what's it called afterwards?
Club 1080.
The clubhouse?
Yeah.
The what?
The Club 1080. Clubhouse. You can call it whatever you want.
We're going to call it, Club Isachi, I'll think of something during the commercial.
Okay. Something involving our Isachi, Isachi colleague. When we come back, I do want to switch sides and talk about kind of a positive side of playing a specific position that relates. The quarterback gets a lot of the good stuff, but there's also a lot of rough stuff that goes along with it. It's a very unique position in the world of sports. I'm going to ask you one particular thing in regards to a couple of these guys coming up in the draft and your thoughts on how important this one thing is. When we come back with Joe Harrington right here on The Fan.
It's time for a Ducks Report, the inside story on Oregon athletics, brought to you by Mods PDX. The future of building is here.
Well, Sook, yesterday after his round, Wyndham Clark said, you know, those live boys, they only play 54 holes. I got plenty of time to catch Bryson. If he can go shoot 7 under, so can I. Well, Wyndham Clark is going home.
Yeah, it did not particularly go well for Wyndham Clark because, you know, when you shoot 73 and say that you can go out and shoot 65 and then you shoot 78, yeah, you missed the cut.
Yeah, he birdied 2, but then had bogeys on 6, 7, 9, 10, 14, 15, and 17.
This Mods PDX Duck Report brought to you by Mods PDX. The future of building is here.
If you're considering new construction and want it done right and fast by a team that's focused on innovation, collaboration, and creativity, you want Mods PDX. At Mods PDX, we craft beautiful, sustainable, energy-efficient buildings of the highest quality. Our modular approach means your project can be completed faster than traditional construction, and our team of uniquely qualified architectural and trade professionals have the expertise and experience to make your vision a reality. Visit us today at modspdx.com.
Yeah. The home of Dirt and Spray.
I'm Dirt.
Well, I wasn't expecting a full season of Damian Martinez personally anyway, but for him to leave, it's not...
vacation. I have to roll up my blue collar sleeves and pay for my own vacation.
Well, I pay for most of my own vacations, just not this one.
And by the way, for the Vancouver Vortex Line people, I don't know what's going on with YouTube. Talk to Buckley.
No, nope, YouTube's back.
Oh, we're back?
Yeah, we're back.
Okay. Now we can see Buck's privilege and all its glory.
That's right.
As you go to your private lake. Maybe that's what Scoot was talking about. Got to go to that lake.
I'm going to go to that lake.
Yeah.
That's right.
All right. We're a little bit long, so we'll get back on the clock. When we come back, I have conjoined twin news. I got pickleball news. We got high rats.
High rats. Okay.
High rats and a choose your own adventure for which party drug you want to be the the next in the line of the Buckley Good Times. Suddenly, a lot to get to. As we roll on here, we'll get back on the clock at Club Isachi here on 1080 The Fan.
Isachi.
Yeah. The home of dirt.
if you don't know, Jennifer Coolidge was like, she's a what would you call it? Like a role actor? She was in like, she's Stifler's like
a
mom.
Almost like a bit actor or something like that. Like,
yeah, she's a character actor.
Character actor, there you go.
She popped up in a handful of things. She was like on some episodes of like Seinfeld, Will and Grace. I think most people knew her as Stifler's mom.
That's
You know, by the way, she was like 33 when that happened.
Yeah, she looked older than that.
Yeah,
a lot
older. She was painted like this like cougar, like 50-year-old, whatever. She was like 33. But now she did that White Lotus thing. And
great show, by the way, if you haven't watched it.
Yeah, I thought White Lotus was all right.
I enjoyed it a lot. I like it because it's different.
Yeah, I didn't quite. Season one, season two, you know, they were fine. I didn't think it was like some sort of cultural phenomenon. But for whatever reason, it caught fire and it was a big deal. And Jennifer Coolidge was the only recurring character in those two, right? She was in both
of
them.
Right, correct. She was a guest at the resort in both, and she was the only one that carried over from season to season.
Yeah. And because of that, like, all of a sudden, Jennifer Coolidge became a deal. Like, she was doing, like, Discover ads.
Yeah.
And all this. And my favorite part is in every commercial, she has to say, it's Jennifer Coolidge.
And that's just it. So I do agree her voice is distinctive. If she's in a commercial on television, her look is distinctive.
But she still says...
But as soon as you have to say, it's Jennifer Coolidge.
And she talks like the Jennifer Coolidge.
But she couldn't even say, it's Jennifer, and like hope that... I mean, I know that they need... If they're going to pony up for whatever her fee is, that they got to make it count, but like...
Because she does
seems odd to me that...
She does those Discover commercials, and she still is like, I'm Jennifer Coolidge. And I also wonder if that's the way she talks, or if she's just doing... a Jennifer Coolidge bit. I'm fascinated.
Well, I think it's what you brought up yesterday in talking about, like, Tiger and, like, with his face being all stiff and stuff. I think she's just had too much work done, and she can't really open her mouth because it's like that.
Yeah, that's true. That's the Dr. Zaius theory that I have, is that if you've watched the old Planet of the Apes, like, the makeup was so bad that they couldn't move their lips, so just the mouth moved. And, yeah, I can see that. She does the...
I would buy that.
I don't think she talked like that, like in American Pie.
Or not to that degree. It wasn't as pronounced.
Yeah, well, facelifts are a hell of a thing. Either way, hey, good for Jennifer Coolidge.
But like, then the funny thing is, like, I know that her character role that they always give her is, like, the ditzy, milfy, like, type, you know? But, like, she... I don't know. It's like she's playing into being a dummy in all these ads. Like, my asparagus sorbet or whatever. And I'm like, what? What are we doing?
Well, I mean... I don't know if she's thrilled about that, but she has to be thrilled to be working.
She's got to be thrilled about one thing.
Well, yeah, if you're Jennifer Coolidge, right? Like, you've been in the business for probably 30 years. Your biggest role to date is, like, 5 minutes in a cheesy teen comedy.
Yeah, where a high school kid wants to boink you.
Yeah, which is a fine role. And, you know, all of a sudden you're getting Discover ads and, you know, this White Lotus thing. I'm sure that has to be a bit of a, like, holy hell. Like, when you think about grinding for that long, I'm guessing that that's her largest payday that she's ever had.
I bet it is, and it's crazy because I would imagine someone like her worked really hard at her craft early in her life. Like, she probably, to get individual spots on things like Seinfeld and stuff like that. And the fact that she's going to end up being known for, like, I mean, this now is really interesting.
Yeah. Jennifer Coolidge. Every time I hear that ad, I'm always like, oh, it's Jennifer Coolidge. And nothing against Jennifer Coolidge. I just wonder, like, have we reached the end of the White Lotus thing ended like a year ago, right?
Yeah, and I mean...
I don't think, like, how long can you ride...
Well, there is a third season coming out, although
she's dead.
That's the thing.
So, like, you just... At what point does, like, the agent stop... You know they're calling anyone and everyone. They're calling Verizon and AT&T. Hey, do you want Jennifer Coolidge? That's got to hurt a little bit. Like, it's a... Get that brief window to capitalize.
Now,
and
do
you're
you think...
probably... Because at her age, and it's a very niche role, I feel kind of bad in that, like, that's... I don't think it ever gets better for Jennifer Coolidge unless she starts doing Henry Winkler eyes. She needs a father-in-law to have some sort of ailment pronto. Because that's another one that's a little odd. Henry Winkler, out of nowhere.
My eyes are very important to me.
So that's for, like, macular degeneration?
Or something.
So somewhere, like, I'm fascinated how these deals come about. Like, somewhere along the line, some macular degeneration society was like, hey, we need a spokesman. And someone went
They're like, who are all the old people? And has anyone have any connection to eye issues, anyone in their family? And like Henry Winkler's agent raised his hand? Is that how that happens?
It was just like, I don't know. Like, well, I guess his father-in-law, his eyes were very important to him. But I mean, I'm fascinated how random celebrities get to those roles, get to that specific thing. Because, like, I get it. Like, if you see George Clooney doing, like, an espresso ad or whatever, I get it. It's George Clooney. Sure. You know, that makes sense. He's a big enough star that he probably doesn't need any sort of, if you want George Clooney to be your guy, you pony up for him. And if George Clooney says yes, you go with it. You're like, great. But when you get the random, like Walter Brimley became the face of diabetes. Like, what did Walter Brimley do for, like, the last 25 years of his career? Other than he did the diabetes commercial.
Mm-hmm.
How did he become the face of diabetes? There's lots of old guys.
He had a unique way of saying diabetes.
Yeah, there's lots of old guys. You know? Someone saying, how long can Jennifer Coolidge be Jennifer Coolidge? Ask Wanda Sykes. But Wanda Sykes is a stand-up comedian.
Right.
Like, that's a little different because, you know, she goes out and she does tours. And, like, I literally don't know what Jennifer Coolidge has been doing for 20 years until I saw her in White Lotus. And the moment she was in White Lotus, I saw her started popping up in commercials.
Yeah, and this, I'm also wondering, I mean, her voice and her look are distinctive. Are the companies hiring her because when you hear her or see her, you're like, oh, I know that person, like the recognizability? Or you're like, everyone remembers White Lotus, so of course they'll remember her.
I don't know.
I'm trying to figure out, like, why she's the one that they want.
Well,
you know?
Maybe it's like one of those where it's like a sweet spot where you can't really, you don't want to pay for like a big star, but you also don't want someone that no one's heard of.
So you don't want a big ticket, but you want someone really recognizable, perhaps.
Well, and I guess, I don't know, just someone's like, that damn that Jennifer Coolidge, she's so hot right now. And then you go out and now there'll be another show. There'll be some other show that'll come along. Like, I don't know, like who's the guy, the Logan Roy guy from...
Brian Cox.
Brian Cox?
Mm-hmm.
Now, he's more successful, but I could see Brian Cox, like, if he started popping up in commercials... I could see that.
He's done the McDonald's voiceovers.
Yes,
he
does
that.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
How long has he been doing those? Did he get those because of Succession?
I wonder. I feel like he did start getting them after season one of Succession. But I don't know. I'll have to look into that.
Because I love that stuff.
Someone
said Tom Selleck for reverse mortgages. Exactly.
Oh, you know what?
It'll just be the most random thing in the world. And you're like, how the hell did they get Tom Selleck to do reverse mortgages?
The one that goes all the way back to, like, my childhood. You remember when the TV show 24 with Kiefer Sutherland was a phenomenon?
Yeah.
Well, the most trustworthy person was President David Palmer.
Yeah.
And he became, like, that's Allstate.
Yes.
You know, you're in Allstate's hands or whatever. And, like, he became the insurance pitchman because he was the trustworthy president from 24. And then he rode that for, like, a decade and a half.
I was working out once, and, you know, they got the TVs, like, in the background. And they were doing it was, like, one of those infomercials, but it ran for, like, a half hour. Right, it was like and it was for like an auto shield or a home. It was for like a warranty program.
Okay,
I don't remember if it was a home warranty or if it was an auto warranty, but it was one of those, like, you know, they do you have a car that's 10 years older, or is your house, like, waiting for the water heater to blow up? Then get, you know, this. And it was fascinating. I got to look this up because it was I remember sitting there. I was, like, on the rowing machine. I couldn't take my eyes off of it because it was the most random group of people of all time. It had the gal from 30 Rock, the blonde girl that did, remember the...
Jane Krakowski.
She did the rule juror.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah.
It was like Jane Krakowski and it was like four or five of them. But the best part, Ice-T. Like the guy that did Cop Killer.
It's like the company just went to an agency and said, this is our budget. How many people that people know can you give us? And then you just threw them all together.
Right.
Or something.
And I want to be sitting in the room when someone goes to Ice-T, of all people, like Ice-T, and they're like, hey, T. I don't know what they call him, Ice or T. They're like, hey, T, got something for you, man. What? It's day's work. I don't know, pays, let's go, like 100 G's? I don't know what does that run? Like 250? I don't know. But let's say like 200. Hey, runs 200 G's. It's gonna be like half day's work. What's it for? Home warranties. Like, what? It's like, I'm
He's like,
even...
is the check going to clear? Fine. Like,
home warranties. And by the way, you're going to be working with that girl from 30 Rock and Flo from Progressive.
And how often do you think they show up and don't even know who the other person is?
I don't know.
Yeah.
It's fascinating.
It is.
Like, and Tom Selleck is a big deal. Like, Tom Selleck is Magnum PI, but Tom Selleck's doing a reverse mortgage? How much money does it take to get Tom Selleck to do reverse mortgages? Well, I'm just, this stuff blows me away.
And this was awkward. Before I came back here to The Fan, I was with NBC Sports Northwest, and we would have to run infomercial, like filler programming between like the morning radio show, like the Brian Noe show, and then when we get into the afternoon stuff, whether it's like The Bridge or Talking Ducks or whatever Blazers programming is on, like the middle of the day needed to be filled somehow, and we didn't have all reruns.
Yeah.
Well, there was one of those half-hour-long things, and it was like Larry King was selling,
yes,
was selling some sort of like pill or supplement,
yeah, it was some
or something.
Sort of vitamin thing.
I
remember those.
During the run, Larry King died, and they kept running them every day.
I remember
and
that.
I remember going to our GM at the time, or like our executive producer, and saying, I mean, I'm sure that this company has a contract or whatever, but like, he died. Should we keep running this thing that he just sit there at the table talking about the pills? Like,
yes.
And he's like, "What? I mean, they ran it up the line to corporate, and they're like, no, they want to keep running it." So,
well, there was one of those too where Dick Butkus, remember, it was running on our airwaves. I don't remember what it was, but like, it was some random thing, and Dick Butkus was their spokesman. And I don't know how Dick, like, they were like, and like Dick Butkus was like, I've known these guys for like 30 years. And you're like, Dick Butkus? And then Dick Butkus died. And for like a month afterwards, we still ran the spots where it was like, Dick Butkus for, you know, something tamales. And he's like, I've been eating these tamales for 30 years. They're my best friends. And you're like, and I want to know, does Dick Butkus know those guys? Or again, did they go find random Dick Butkus? Fascinates me. The world of advertising, it's a hell of a thing. And yes, the iced tea one is Car Shield. The
Car Shield, okay.
Car,
yeah,
Shield.
Yeah. Yep.
Yes. And I'm trying to find who the other people were, but it was just the most bewildering group of random celebrities I've ever seen in my entire life, and I couldn't take my eyes off of it. And maybe that's the key, right? If it's someone big and famous for eye degeneration stuff, maybe you don't think anything about it. But when it's Henry Winkler and his father-in-law's eyes are very important to him, we all remember that.
Okay, I'm looking this up now. There's Vivica A. Fox shows up in one with him.
Yes. Oh, and the guy from Ghostbusters. The non-famous one.
Yeah, I know the guy you're talking about.
The black Ghostbuster.
Yeah.
I forget, the Ernie Hudson?
I think that's right.
Vivica A. Fox, Ernie Hudson, and Ice-T? What? And they're
They've also mixed in Allen Iverson and Ric Flair.
And they're selling me car warranties. I didn't know I needed a car warranty, but Ice-T and Ric Flair? Dude, count me in. My God. Fascinating. And Dick Butkus. And then some eye problems with Henry Winkler. Come back. I'll try to get to this conjoined twin story. And the latest craze in party drugs. You're going to want to try this. Club 1080. Here, though, Buck with Sports Arm.
My eyes are very important to me.
No.
the paper of record on my side of the river over there in the Couve. This was coming from Dr. Kevin Fisher, who's he's on like the he's like the Surgeon General for Clark County, right? He's one of the high up elected officials over there. He's in charge of the well-being, and apparently, there is a brand new drug that is in Clark County, and it has doubled over the last 6 months.
Doubled in volume or doubled in price?
Doubled in volume.
Okay.
And my man here, Dr. Kevin, says that this is now just the new baseline, and it's only going to get worse.
The baseline for what?
Yes. That would be a little thing that we like to call X-line or Trank, a.k.a. horse tranquilizer.
Okay.
Yes. We've moved on. Fentanyl is yesterday's news. We've moved on to horse tranquilizer. So apparently if fentanyl doesn't do it for you, horse tranquilizer.
Okay.
And I saw this, and it was interesting because like 2 minutes before this, I read a story coming out of India, and it made me think which one leads to a better evening.
Oh.
Okay, you're hanging out with some buddies. Right.
I'm going to tell you right now, I feel like horse trank is going to kill my evening. Well, but let's hear what the other one has. Well,
just don't judge until the facts are in. You can't jump to conclusions.
Text line wants to know if Dusty's selling either one.
Look, I'm not here to say what he or is or isn't doing. Okay. I'm just here to report. So, again, we're hanging out maybe under a bridge, maybe outside of a library.
I'm guessing, Frank Reynolds situation.
Well, I'm thinking maybe a trash fire. I don't know where you like score horse tranquilizer, but I'm guessing
the vet.
Well, I guess I'm saying like in like yes from an equine vet, but
on the street.
On the street.
Yeah, that's an under the bridge situation.
I'm guessing if you're getting hooked up with horse tranquilizer, I'm guessing that you're in a basement. You got to prove yourself in the basement. Trash fire, you know, bridge sort of situation.
Tent city.
Yeah. Right. Maybe. It's like, hey. How's our evening going? Ah, it's all right. You want to make it better? Horse tranquilizer. Or Trank.
Or Exine or something, would you say?
Yeah.
Is the other one?
Yeah, that's what they're. That's the actual name of it.
Oh, okay.
X-Y-L-A-Z-I-N-E. Hmm. Exline?
Xylene?
Xylene?
I don't know.
Or that's why I'm guessing why they just go with Trank.
Trank, yeah.
A.K.A. horse tranquilizer. It is fascinating, though, that someone is taking a tranquilizer that's made for a... I don't know, what, an 18 to 2,000 pound animal?
Yeah.
Like, that's a large amount. If it can tranquilize a horse.
Hope you're microdosing.
Well, maybe you're going to have a grand old time. So, again, I'm asking you. You have to take one of these.
Okay.
You're at a party.
Okay.
You don't want to be the lame guy around the trash fire that's like, no thanks.
No trank for me.
No trank for me. I'm sticking to my fentanyl. And they're like, nah, fentanyl's old school. So apparently there is an Indian YouTuber named Elvish Yadav.
Nice guy.
And he's a big deal over there. He's got 15 million subscribers.
Seems like a lot.
Yeah, he's a big party guy over there. He's a social media star over in India.
Okay. Influencer?
Influencer. Yeah. Yes. Well, he was recently arrested. Now, he denies that he was responsible for this, but he was arrested at a party. And this, he was arrested and charged and detained under the Wildlife Act.
Oh,
he
boy.
Was not doing horse tranquilizer. Would you care to guess what he was arrested with as a party drug at the Indian raves that he was going to, the Bollywood rave? And I'll let you decide whether that is better or worse than the horse tranquilizer.
You said it has to do with wildlife?
It is wildlife.
So I'm going to say it's like... It's going to be some sort of like psychedelic venom or something. It's going to be like toad or
look, who amongst us hasn't licked a toad or two in our time? No. That's a little lame. Snake venom. New party drug, snake venom.
And so what kind of snakes are we talking about? Cobra venom?
9 snakes, including cobras, were recovered from the party, along with 20 milliliters of snake venom.
Oh, my God.
Yes, he has been arrested.
What does that do to you?
You thought the horse tranquilizer was bad.
Well, and remind me what the horse tranq does to you. I mean, is it just a massive tranquilizer? Is that all it is?
I mean, it's horse tranquilizer.
Yeah,
I'm
I just didn't know if there are like other, you know, parts of the buzz that are particularly attractive. I don't know.
Now, I will say that I have seen someone take horse tranquilizer. I don't know if it was this. There was a guy at BYU. He did not last long at BYU. I don't remember what his name was, but We called him the Berserker because he had
Frank. That's what you called him.
Well, he had a homemade tattoo that he gave himself that said Berserker on it, and it was not spelled correctly. He was an interesting fellow.
Okay.
He took some horse tranquilizer. We ended up having to drive him to the ER and just kind of dump him out in front. And he was dismissed from the team, and I don't know what happened to that young man. He was a defensive lineman.
Okay.
So that's my only, and I don't know where he got the horse tranquilizer. Couldn't tell you. I don't know how he took the horse tranquilizer. I showed up at a place and I was like, hey, what's wrong with him? And they're like, he took some horse tranquilizer. And I was like, is he dead? And everyone was like, oh.
Could be on the way.
We're like, we should probably like call an ambulance. And they were like, well, you don't want to call an ambulance. So we're like, what if we just took him to the ER? And that was the decision. So you got horse tranq, or do you go down the road of snake venom?
Now, I need to know more about this.
It's snake. Don't you have to take the horse tranq? I think you have to take the horse tranquilizer.
Well, I need to know what the snake venom is going to do to other, or what it has done to other people before I decide.
Well, I don't know. Like, it
obviously it's venom, so it's supposed to kill you.
That's my point. I'm reading through this story, and it doesn't sound like they're doing
not
anything
a whole lot of upside
with the snake venom.
What are we doing this
they're
for?
They're just doing snake venom.
Just to say they did it?
I don't, like, what? It's snake venom. Why would you,
well,
the horse tranquilizer.
Is it going to give me a buzz, the snake venom?
Well, I guess, I don't know, but at least the horse tranquilizer, I'm assuming that gives you a buzz. I don't know. It probably makes you feel some sort of way. It's a tranquilizer. It's the downer. Snake venom? This is where we're at. We've run out of things to do, so now we've gone.
Because,
well,
venom can do all sorts of things. It can sting and irritate. It can disorient. Like, they're like venom in nature has a lot of different ways it can mess with you. Here's the thing. While I agree, the sound of venom is scarier. The fact that you're taking tranquilizer made for like a 2,000-pound beast scares me more. That you might mix up the dosage, you just off yourself. Whereas if you got something kind of weird going on with the venom.
Really?
I don't know.
You're going snake venom.
You're
about the snake venom.
Maybe I am. I don't know.
Huh. Yeah, I'm reading here. This is from the New England Journal of Medicine. It says, the abuse of snake venom as a way to get high among the thrill-seeking addicts is on the rise in metro cities of India. A direct snake bite and snake venom pill are being used at rave parties to get the high. Of all the normal forms of psychoactive substances used or reported, snake venom represents the potentially most lethal form. You think?
Yeah, I'm reading here now the National Institutes of Health are saying that snake venom used can be used as a substitute for opioids.
Snake venom, huh?
I don't...
Boy, that is something else. Like, the idea of showing up at a party and someone's like, hey, do you want to get bit? Because they said in that... Not only you can ingest it or you can get bit. So someone's just walking around with a venomous snake and they're like, here, get bit.
Okay, I'm not signing up for that. I am signing up. If I'm signing up for anything here, it is a pre-portioned amount of venom that does not come directly from the source. I'm letting a snake freaking bite me to get my high.
Mm.
I'm not doing any of this to get my high, but yeah.
Boy, I'm telling you what. I'm taking the horse tranquilizer all day, every day.
And it's not even close. I need to know more.
Not even close. The horse tranquilizer.
I'd be worried about the horse tranquilizer stopping my heart.
The horse tranquilizer. Look, you're going to roll the dice. We're here to party, all right? This isn't a bunch of candy asses. We're not here doing fentanyl.
Oh, when you're tranked out, you're just going to be asleep on the couch. Where's the fun in that?
Look, at least the tranquilizer is meant as some sort of medicine, right? It's something to
induce. But it doesn't mean party. It just means sleepy time.
It's better than venom is meant to kill.
Venom could be kind of sweet.
I think you're into snake venom.
Maybe.
You'd really do the snake venom. This isn't even a thought.
This was born more out of the fear of messing up the dose of a tranquilizer built for an animal 20 times our size.
You know, the cobra venom is meant to kill you.
I know that.
One's not meant to kill.
I'm not. Listen, there are no. Well, are there no right answers or no wrong answers here? I'm not sure.
I think the right answer is just lick some toads.
Yeah,
right?
Probably.
Well, you can probably die from that too.
Imagine.
Yeah, but given the choice, right? Like, you lick toads. You lick the toads, then it's the horse tranquilizer, then it's the snake venom has to be last. It has to. Unless you're Ryan Buckley.
I'm reading now more about snake venom use, and there's a case study of a 33-year-old male. with the help of some nomadic snake charmers, subjected himself to snake bites over the tip of his tongue. The snake bite was associated with jerky movements of the body, blurring vision, and unresponsiveness, i.e. blackout.
Boy. Look, I like to party, boy, man, there is just... The amount that people are willing to go to have a good time fascinating.
Here's why they're doing it at raves, dude.
What do we got at raves?
After waking up, he experienced a heightened arousal and sense of well-being, which lasted for 3 to 4 weeks.
The snake venom gets you horny?
And, it does that. Let's see. What else? There's more here. It says, according to the patient, during these 3 to 4 weeks, he did not have any craving for alcohol or opioids.
So what you're saying is the key to the drug problem in Portland, snake venom.
If we could just import some more snakes, then people would at least have the sense of well-being to believe that, you know, that life has some meaning and whatnot. So,
and as someone points out on the Vancouver Ford text line, we figured out that Buck likes uppers.
It says that after the 3 to 4 weeks, a sense of well-being started to decline. He started to become more irritable, lethargic, and started having cravings for drugs again. So the venom kept him aroused and happy.
Oh. All right, so you're happy with with the boner. All right, snake venom. Man, India. I'm just going to put that as reason 8 million not to go to India.
I've been. It's not going to surprise you.
Well, your privilege shows.
I know.
India, private lakes in California. Club Asachi when we come back. Prime time here on The Fan.
What's your opinion?
It's thick, it's meaty.
The AAA Heating and Cooling poll question gives you a chance to vote on the hottest topics of the day, according to Isaac and Sue.
They were more excited than I was because I did it.
Brought to you by AAA Heating and Cooling, a family business helping families for over 50 years. Visit AAAIAQ.com. The AAA Heating and Cooling poll question. Vote now on Twitter at 1080 The Fan.
Hello, friends, and welcome to Chehalem Glen Golf Course in beautiful wine country out in Newburgh, Oregon. One of the best courses in the region and just a short drive from Portland, Chehalem Glen is the ultimate test, even for the most seasoned golfer. With rolling fairways, beautiful views of the Chehalem Mountains, and affordable tee times, Chehalem Glen is a great way to master your game. So come spend your round of 18 holes at Chehalem Glen Golf Course. Right off Highway 99 in Newburgh, book your tee time at ChehalemGlen.com.
3 days only, today through Sunday. This is a great opportunity to save thousands on hundreds of in-stock spas. Portland Expo Center. Huge factory incentives and factory rebates on the spas you've always wanted. Don't miss this opportunity. Free professional delivery. Take possession tomorrow, next week, next month, or next season. The Hot Tub and Swim Spa Sale. Portland Expo Center. Shop over a dozen models of swim spas from 11 feet to over 19 feet. Swim spas offer low impact exercise, active family fun, unsurpassed relaxation, and installation in one day. The Hot Tub and Swim Spa Sale. Find the spa you've always wanted. Free admission. You can't afford to miss this. This is a great opportunity to save thousands on hundreds of in-stock spas. Today, noon to 8, Saturday, 10 to 8, Sunday, 10 to 6. The Hot Tub and Swim Spa Sale. Portland Expo Center. Visit HotTubAndSwimSpaSale.com.
Baseball is back, basketball is heating up, and the NFL draft is right around the corner. Listen to the latest on the teams you love with the free Odyssey app. The biggest sports radio stations in the country, providing unrivaled local coverage of their teams, all in one place. Exclusive interviews with players, coaches, and team executives, streaming live and always available on demand. Stay in the know with your favorite teams with Odyssey, AUDACY. Download the free Odyssey app today.
When people have a craving to explore new and traditional Asian cuisines, they head to P.F. Chang's, where scratch-made dishes come from the 2,000-year-old tradition of wok cooking. P.F. Chang's wanted to explore new possibilities for their website. They turned to AmericanEagle.com. AmericanEagle.com re-architected P.F. Chang's website, integrating multiple third-party systems to create a unified digital experience. The results? Improved page speed and performance, personalized content based on users' location, intuitive online ordering, and increase in organic search visibility and a 40% increase in new users. For scratch-made Asian cuisine, visit your local P.F. Chang's or go to pfchangs.com for website design, development, digital marketing, and hosting that produce efficiency, revenue, and results. Visit AmericanEagle.com. P.F. Chang's and AmericanEagle.com. Another example of the best business